It's time for TWiT This Week in Tech. Andrew Cunningham from Ars Technica joins Jason Heiner from CBS Interactive and our old pal Jeff Jarvis from This Week in Google to talk about the latest news. Google becomes Alphabet, Tesla announces the X, and a whole lot more. It's all coming up next. This Week in Tech is here.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for This Week in Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is TWiT, This Week in Tech, episode 530, recorded Sunday, October 4th, 2015. I am Chapter 9. This Week in Tech is brought to you by Braintree. Looking to set up payments for your business? Braintree gives your app or website a payment solution that accepts just about every payment method with one easy integration. Plus, Braintree will give you the first $50,000 in transactions fee-free. To learn more, visit BraintreePayments.com/TWiT. And by Stamps.com. Use Stamps.com to buy and print real U.S. postage the instant you need it right from your desk. For our special offer, go to Stamps.com now. Click on the microphone and enter TWIT. That's stamps.com. Offer code TWIT. And by audible.com. Sign up for the Platinum Plan and get 2 free books. Go to audible.com/TWIT2. And don't forget to follow Audible on Twitter. User ID audible_com. And by Carbonite. You never know when disaster will strike at work or at home. Prepare for the unexpected with Carbonite. Protect digital files on your computer or server with secure automatic cloud backup from Carbonite. Visit Carbonite.com today and get 2 free bonus months with the offer code TWIT. It's time for TWIT This Week in Tech, the show where we cover the week's tech news with the greatest journalists in technology. And I'm really glad that we got a great panel for you. We'll start on my left here with Jeff Jarvis, who is our regular on This Week in Google,
the author. That's so funny to hear you say This Week in Tech. I was going to correct you and say, no. This Week in Google.
You're on, as Andrew Cunningham said, the big show.
I'm at the grown-ups table.
Which is silly, because I think there is no grown-up show, more grown-up show than This Week in Google that we do on the network. But I'm glad you're here. It's always fun to have you.
Here, at the grown-ups table, we get to drink.
That is the difference. Nice to have you.
No Shirley Temples for me.
Jeff is a professor of journalism at CUNY. He is the author of several very good books, including What Would Google Do?, Public Parts, his latest, Geeks Bearing Gifts, about the reinventing the news industry. We'll talk about that in a little bit. You want to reinvent the ad business as well. Blogger at BuzzMachine.com. Also joining us from Ars Technica, their senior products editor, Andrew A. Cunningham. Great to have you, Andrew.
Hey, thanks for having me.
He's got blisters on his fingers, having completed the first post-John Syracuse review of an OS X update.
Yeah, someone's got to do it.
Actually, it took 2 of you to do it, right?
Yeah, we had 2 of us, and then one other person contributed some stuff on networking. He is a hard person to replace.
Wow. Wow. When you must have had chills go down your spine when Syracuse said, I don't think I'm going to do this anymore.
It's I was worrying about it for years, and then the hammer finally came down.
Well, we'll talk about it. OS X, El Capitan. And Andrew has lots more to talk about. You can see him at ArsTechnica.com and on Twitter at Andrew Writes. Also want to welcome another great writer and a longtime member of the TWiT family, Jason Heiner from CBS Interactive. Hey. And I owe him a big thank you. People have been asking me all year, how come they never write about you and Follow the Geeks?
Yeah.
Jason,
they've been saying it to us too.
Yeah, Jason Heiner and Lindsay Gilpin have written a really good book. You're almost done now. If you've been following along at home, you could read each chapter for a month online. Or is it a month or a couple of weeks online?
It is. It's basically a month. We've been releasing one chapter a month. As we finish them, we've been releasing them online, and then the full book is released at the end of the year.
How exciting! You got one more chapter.
One more mystery, eh?
One more mystery, and this one...
I see lots of nominees. Everybody say, well, hey, you forgot so-and-so, and you forgot so-and-so. You gotta do so-and-so.
I'm just so honored. So honored to be included, because it really is. It's a great book, and many of my great friends are in it. And as I told you, this is probably the only chance I'm going to get a biography. So I am grateful. And as about as complete a biography as you can get, you wrote a lot. And interviewed my mom and Kate Botello and my wife.
Amazing.
Yeah, is my mom amazing? Yeah. What a character.
Love your mom.
Yeah.
She's incredible.
Some great stories. Great stories. So thank you for doing that. And people can read it right now. Followthegeeksbook.com. Baratunde, Veronica Belmont. You've had some.
Gina Trapani.
Gina Trapani. So many great people. In this Lisa Bettany. Yeah. Tom Merritt. Om Malik. Chase Jarvis, the photographer. Juliana Rotich, the founder of Ushahidi. And now me, and one more chapter to go. Who's left?
Yeah. Who's mystery guest number 10? We've had a lot of guests. As Jeff was saying, you know, we've had a lot of people guessing, especially today, you know, after the talk of, you know, your chapter. I think everybody kind of guessed that you were likely in there, right? I think, and certainly requested. But the last one, I doubt anyone will guess. The last one is one of someone that everybody will, I think, be blown away by, no one will guess. That's pretty big billing.
Will everyone know who this person is?
No one knows who it is.
No, I don't mean that. I mean, when they see the name, they'll say, I know who that is.
No, most people won't. But after they read
obscure.
It. Kind of. Well, obscure in the circles that most of the people here are in. But widely known in some other circles, but dovetails perfectly with kind of where we're going in terms of the future. Because really the book is a lot about
enigmatic clue.
I've never done this to you, Jason, but you know, what can I say? It's Jeff gets to.
One clue.
Enigmatic.
Enigmatic.
Well, that's a clue. That's redundant, I guess. But yes, one clue.
Yes. Phrase it in the form of a riddle, please.
Patterson in our chat room says, it's Arlene Dahl from What's My Line? Only Jeff Jarvis and I would even get that joke. That's awesome. Yeah.
This person has been, has rubbed shoulders with some very famous talk show hosts this year. I don't know how good of a clue that
Stop
is.
Stop it. No more. We don't want to spoil it.
Oz was just on Jimmy Fallon with a great episode.
Who was?
Oz.
How about Elon Musk? Show. How many of you watched the Tesla announcement this week?
Yeah.
Tesla X, because it has doors that go like this.
I didn't see it, but I'm reading all his commentary about it.
Elon seems to have really hit his stride as a presenter.
You know, I agree. The thing that was amazing to me was when he did that battery unveiling. And like, how interesting can you make a battery?
Right.
I mean, let's be honest. But he kept it to 20 to 25 minutes, if I remember correctly. And at the end, I was like, oh my God, like this was amazing. Like, how did he make a battery interesting? And I thought, this is pretty significant, actually. Because in the past, I've seen a lot of the times he's spoken and hasn't always been, you know, riveting. But that battery, he made it about the fact that, you know, look, we've got
saving the world.
It was about saving the world. Yeah. Exactly. And somehow he convinced, I think pretty convincingly, made us believe that buying this battery would help save the world, at least in some small way.
He's kind of convinced me, I have to say. I've resisted buying the Tesla, but after the event, I finally put in a reservation. Just a reservation.
For the new model.
For the Model X. Because it has doors that go like this.
I mean, it's got the Back to the Future doors.
You know, one of the reasons, actually, Jason Calacanis, who was on the new Screensavers yesterday, was an early Tesla adopter, has all of them. In fact, I think was the first guy on the reservation list for the Model S. He told me there's a supercharger in Petaluma. So these are the free refill electrical refill stations that charge really fast, like 100 miles range in half an hour.
Well, you know, I was thinking about this. So he promised that in 2017, I think it is, he'll get up to 600 miles.
620, yeah.
So to me, this is that's it. That's it. As far as you can drive in a day without complete butt rot.
Yeah.
That's it.
That's
right?
The metric.
The butt rot rule.
The butt rot metric, yeah. Yeah.
500 or 600 miles. Then all the objections I have to it are gone.
Jason.
So Leo, let me just ask you this. Your Mondo killer, wonderful, amazing, super duper Audi isn't diesel, is it?
No.
Okay.
I would feel so guilty, and I feel so bad for the people who bought diesel Volkswagens and Audi A4s after in the aftermath of the revelation that these cars had software that would trick the testers to appear to be ecologically suitable, but then as soon as they got off the dynamometer, 40 times the nitrogen.
Oof.
It's making me cough just to think about it. the massive polluters. And I feel so bad for people who drove that car thinking they were driving an eco-friendly car. In fact, one of the worst cars on the road. That's terrifying, terrible. So, but this, an electrical, as we know, electric vehicles aren't necessarily non-polluting. The electricity has to be generated somewhere. I thought this was interesting. The car filter that has a bioweapon mode. Yeah.
This is where it goes back.
So this is the largest car filter, air filter in any car. And remember, you don't need an air filter because there's no gas engine. So the air filter is just for the passengers. And he showed it off. As you can see, he's showing it off here. And in fact, showed the buttons. And he's can you hear the audio on this? I don't know if you... what I like about Elon is he's off script. There's no script. He's just doing it. He's talking from his heart.
And his brain,
and his brain.
Area, but the quality of the filter is greater. So that translates to a several hundredfold improvement in the filtration capability. It is.
I don't know why they're focusing on this. But because this is what he cares about.
Leo, I heard that he'll have a software update coming soon, which is a zombie evasion.
Well, there is a button. Let me see if I can find the part where the bioweapon defense mode. Listen.
And he's not
you just
joking.
Press the bioweapon defense mode button. This is a real button.
And the geeks go crazy.
Wow. Yeah.
This isn't a joke. This is serious.
So what... we're trying to be a leader in a public defense scenario.
I swear to God, it's the zombie attack.
So let's move on.
Anyway, I did order this, not because of the bioweapon defense, but just I feel a little guilty driving.
So what were your options? Just battery size?
I haven't gotten them yet. So you make the reservation, and then you will get an email when it's your turn in line to customize it.
To order it.
So I don't know, I'll fill you in.
All these are all-wheel drive, right? This model.
I don't know anything about it. I just ordered it. Sight unseen.
That's so you. It's new. Okay. Just squirrel. I'll buy a squirrel.
Well, my Audi lease runs out in October and of next year, so that's about when this would be available. It just seemed like the right thing to do. I don't know. I love the idea that I could charge it for free.
Well, Leo,
look at that. The doors and this. I'll never have one of them fancy cars with the doors, but this will the doors like that. That's awesome. Somebody pointed out, actually, that interestingly enough, they focused on some interesting things. For instance, these doors that you could just get in. He said that eventually they will have it that you can drive into the charger, and the charger will come out and automatically attach. You don't have to get out of the car.
Well, especially if you're in biodefense mode, you don't want to get out of the car.
Well, and the new seats, he really emphasized how much room there was under the seats to stow stuff, even though the thing is an SUV, has plenty of room in the back. Somebody said this is all evidence that he intends for this to be the first autonomous taxi cab.
It was an interesting piece, you can approach the car, it'll open for you. You can put things in. It's not really your car. You stow things. Yeah.
The door opens when the driver approaches. It senses your presence and opens up.
Is it like geofencing? It's doing some kind of geofencing off of like your fob or your phone or something.
Presumably more securely than the current one-touch fobs work. But I think, and Elon himself said this is as close to autonomous as you could get today. Does so many things automatically, and it's just there it goes driving off all by itself. It's just this close, and I feel like this could it be we're getting closer and closer to autonomous vehicles. Matt Honan on BuzzFeed wrote a very interesting article in which he said there are an inevitability, and how many tens of thousands of people die in the U.S. every year from auto accidents that would be eliminated if we had autonomous vehicles, or presumably be eliminated. So I figure I'll get this car and eventually I won't have to drive anymore. It'll just drive me. Actually, what the article presupposed was that people would still own the car, but then when they're not using it, they would let others rent
it. That's right. Well, but it's obvious you could also start a company that does this, you know. Yeah. So Uber, I mean, this is the ultimate attack on labor, of course. So it's Uber without drivers.
Yeah. Which Uber would love, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah.
It's interesting. Uber buys a lot of ads. Almost all of them are not ads for riders. They're rides for drivers.
Really?
I was talking to a radio executive in Los Angeles this week, and he said, yeah, we sell a ton of ads to Uber. They're just for drivers. They're all for drivers. They need more. They need drivers much more than they need riders, apparently.
It's like listening to Sirius. It's nothing but truck driver ads.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a good business to get into. I there's so much to talk about. I guess we could. Andrew, did you go to the Google event, or did Ron Amadio go? Who went to it?
Ron Amadio was there. I was helping like remotely with his coverage of it, but he was the one who was actually on the ground. Now I watched the live stream and everything, and we were just talking about what a good presenter Elon Musk is, and I've got to say I kind of wish somebody at Google was as good on stage as he is.
Yet I have to say, Sundar Pichai, the CEO of Google, and now, by the way, as of Friday, this is all official. Alphabet's real. He's the official CEO of Google. He got on stage and was there for a minute. And then the impression I got is Google is a large, diverse company full of smart people. And I'm sure that was the intent. Unlike an Apple event where Tim Cook really runs the game or Steve Jobs ran the show, Sundar got out of the way. And they just handed it off. And I thought that was, you're right. I mean, it wasn't, these aren't showbiz folks. I think they were competent. Were you bored?
Yeah, it was just all a little stilted. And they were making these jokes that were supposed to sound like they were off the cuff, but they'd obviously been made like five or six times before. Nothing against any of the products that were introduced. It's just there weren't any show people among the presenters on stage, I don't think.
No. They announced two new phones, the 5X, the X is for Nexus, the 5P, the P is for premium.
I believe that's right.
That's what they said. 5.2 inches for the Nexus 5X, 5.7 inches for the Nexus 5P. It looked beautiful. Solid body, aluminum phone. Both have very good quality cameras with the largest, to my knowledge, the largest pixel size on any sensor, camera phone sensor, 1.55 microns is sounds small, and I guess technically it is small, but it's big for a camera phone. I think these are going to be pretty killer devices.
I can't wait for mine to arrive.
And it's not, and the price is, unlike the Nexus 6, the price is very aggressive. Yes.
Yeah, not quite down to where the Nexus 4 and the original Nexus 5 were a couple of years ago, which is too bad. But yeah, much better than it was last year, especially for the 5X, which is the one that I think I'm the most interested in. I think the Nexus 5 is the best Nexus phone that they've ever done. So
yeah, a lot of people would agree with you on that. And the 5X doesn't seem much compromised. I mean, it's you know, pretty high spec device, just a smaller screen, a plastic body, not a aluminum body. It's an 808 instead of an 810 Snapdragon, a little bit smaller.
Which might be a good thing, depending on your perspective.
It might be. Battery life might be better. I mean, I've never seen anybody say, hey, my phone is so slow. That is not really the, you know, issue. Battery life is the issue. So maybe a little slower processor, a little lower res screen, you might get better battery life on this thing. I'm glad they're doing the Type-C connector. I'm a believer. And they're giving away a $50 credit to the Play Store when you buy it.
Which Lord knows I'll use.
Well, I would guess trying to woo away Apple iPhone users, right? Say, well, you'll get enough money. Because that's one of the sticking points is you've invested in apps. You don't want to have to buy all new apps. Well, here's $50 so you don't have to. And 3 months on Google Play Music, which, of course, Apple's doing with Apple Music. They've also announced an Apple-like Nexus Protect program that gives you an extra year of warranty, even from accidental damage, although there's a $75 deductible, and you can use it twice in the 2 years span.
Yeah, the way they market these and advertise these is always kind of interesting, because they're straddling this line where they started life kind of as developer phones, and right. that's still one of the audiences they appeal the most to, because they get the fast updates and there's no bloatware or anything. But then you have things like Nexus Protect and the Google Play Credit and the Google Play Music stuff that are obviously like intended more for consumers. Yeah. So I'm never quite sure who the intended audience for these things is.
Well, I also think that they have to answer the Genius Bar, is that you could have some place you can take your phone and whine and they'll do something, and Google has to be able to match that.
Right. Especially I think with the Huawei phone, because I don't think they have an entrenched like US support system.
God, no.
Yeah,
that's a really good point. Really good point, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, the 64 gig 6P, I should say, at $550 is a couple hundred bucks less than a comparably equipped iPhone. I mean, it's an aggressive price. Mm-hmm. It's spec-wise seems similar. I mean, you know, it's got a fingerprint reader. It's on the back instead of on the front.
Better screen.
Better. Well, we'll see, of course. All of this, you know, is on paper. You got to see it first. Yeah. But an AMOLED display, 5.7 inches, smaller phone because they don't have the large bezels of the iPhone. I think that's impressive, but I don't think it's the most exciting announcement they made. And I think the jury's out on whether it's the Chromecast audio, which I'm really excited about for reasons probably only I understand, or the Pixel C tablet.
I think that's that. We talked about that on This Week in Google, and the more I've thought about it since our conversation, the more excited I am about that. So I haul around my Chromebook Pixel with me. I have an old one. I can leave one in my office, keep one here, and then if I travel with that, I no longer have to carry the Nexus 7, and I just carry that as an on-the-road laptop. That's pretty exciting.
They still don't have the Pixel C on the store.
I signed up for an alert, email alert. They have that.
Yeah.
If you go to, I think it's...
Is it Pixel?
There's a
Google.com/Pixel. Yeah.
Which is just the
here
C.
It is. Yeah.
Doesn't even mention the Chromebook.
Mm-hmm. And it's only one page.
Yes.
with really no information. But the thing that was impressive on this was the keyboard, and the way the keyboard attached, I thought, was great. Mm-hmm. Magnet flips over.
Can I pitch in on this just real quick?
Jason Howells hosts All About Handwriting. He has a little bit to say about this.
Well, just the thing that worries me about the C is that Android as a platform isn't an amazing platform for multitasking / just getting a lot of things done in the same way that Chrome OS actually does succeed in, or Windows, you know, environment succeeds in. And that's probably why the Surface tablet is so popular, because they've built it with that in mind. I don't get that feeling with Android. And I worry about this. Like, I'm interested in it as a product, because I'm always interested when Google does something different like this based on what they've done in the past, and I want to play around with it. I've tried to use Android devices that have a keyboard attachment and live my life in that to see how it goes. And I find it to be way more inconvenient than an OS that is built for that environment in mind. So
I fear you're
right,
Jason.
I don't know that this is going to solve many problems in that regard. I just think it's going to be another option.
Right. Yeah. Because in one of the really early Android M betas, there was like an experimental, like highly, highly experimental multi-window mode that got removed in later betas, I think. So I'm wondering if we're going to see like an Android 6.1 or like 7.0 down the line or something that will reintroduce that feature, kind of like Samsung has got it, kind of like iOS just introduced in iOS 9. If we're going to see with this particular device, if we're going to see some of those new built-in features that are kind of alleviate that and make multitasking a little bit easier.
I think you're right. Remember when Android came out, it was not for tablets and was kludged onto tablets, and Google didn't endorse that and didn't work very well. Mm-hmm. So maybe this, but my fear is, I mean, I agree with you, Jason. There are some who think this is the death of Chrome OS, but at the same time, Chrome OS brags that it'll have more devices in schools than all other devices combined. And I think for corporate use, I think Chrome OS is going to stick around. Do you think so?
I hope so.
I don't think it's going anywhere.
No, I don't think it's going anywhere. And if it did, that would be a big, big oversight. Primarily for that, right? Like, Chrome OS is amazing in the educational space. It's super, super convenient. Way easier for students to just remember their login credentials on whatever machine they happen to be on and have it all thrown onto the system and everything.
And I think it'll push into enterprise too. I think salespeople and stuff. I think there's a few improvements you can make to Chrome that'll make it work as an office machine.
So who's buying tablets then?
I mean, what we're seeing is, at least in business, you know, because on Tech Republic, that's what we do a lot of, right? And we talk to a lot of companies and talk about what they're using and CIOs and that kind of thing. And, you know, a lot of what they're using tablets for, when they go to iPads are typically like one apps, you know, like there's one app that they're trying to access, or maybe two or three, but they only ever do one at a time. Similar to like what Jason is saying with Android, because, you know, they're purpose-built. It's a purpose-built operating system for doing one thing at a time. And that's its strength and its weakness. But where we're seeing Windows and some traction, where we're seeing Windows have traction, especially Surface, is when people want to do multiple things and they need to run multiple apps and they need to, you know, work back and forth between things, and they have things that, you know, they have to integrate. In those cases, that's where Surface is making a lot of traction. And there's no doubt that that's why Apple, knowing this as well, put out the iPad Pro and is focusing so much on this sort of side-by-side window thing and all of that. And so it'll be interesting to see where the Pixel kind of fits in with that.
Jason's frozen.
Did I freeze?
Yeah, you did. You're back now, though.
Stop using that tablet. Start using a real computer.
Exactly. Where I think it'll be interesting to see with the Pixel C is, where does it play? Does it try to take Android and turn it into a multitasking operating system? Because as Jason Howell was saying, you know, surprisingly, what people may not realize is you can multitask pretty well on a Chromebook. You know, now the Chromebook Pixel, like these guys are talking about.
You can multitask on an iPad. You can multitask. Why? I don't really. Does Android do such a bad job of multitasking? I mean,
I think it's more about
it's full screen. I guess.
Right. Yeah. It's more about having more than one thing on screen at once. Because I will say, you know, since iOS 9, and since all my apps, so like Word and Slack and Tweetbot, are all updated to support all the split view screen stuff now, I am using it a lot more to do work. If maybe at this point it's only just to see if I can use it for work, but it's a lot more possible than it was like 6 months ago even.
I'll tell you one issue, which is the tabs in the Chrome browser on Android are a pain in the butt. Mm-hmm. They don't display.
Yep. Yep.
Right. And you have to go to them and try to and they'll add up to be 100 of them, and it's a pain. Yeah. These things are easily fixed.
I've been saying a lot, though, on the radio show that we have to get out of the mindset of, you need a computer, you need a general purpose machine like a Windows or a Mac machine. Because to make it a general purpose machine, you have to make it so much more complex, which makes it more of a security risk. It makes it more difficult to use. It makes things break more easily. And more, I think, the way people really use technology, a general purpose computer is the wrong thing. I'm not sure a tablet's the right thing. I think you're right. A tablet.
This is why I knew you would join the Chrome.
I have
cult.
Joined the Chrome crowd.
Joined the cult.
No, but even your phone is a better tool in many cases. I agree that tablets and phones tend to be more consumption focused. A Chromebook can actually get work done on.
Yeah, for Twit folks who don't know my rantings on Twig. I've now been my only computer other than one used to talk to Twig.
Because we make him use Skype.
Skype. Thank you, Microsoft.
Sorry.
Is a Chromebook Pixel. It's been, almost 2 years now.
2 years? Wow.
I think. Year and a half, 2 years? Yeah, whenever they come
out. And you don't feel constrained. And of course, you're a writer and a professor. A lot of the stuff you do could be done very easily on a Chromebook. You don't do video editing.
Video I can't do so well, but I don't do any video.
Yeah. No, I think so. And I think that a lot of people don't do the kind of heavy-duty stuff you need a general-purpose computing platform for. That's old school. That's the way it used to be. And we just haven't gotten out of the habit yet. Although, I have to say, I really wonder what the future of the tablet is. I just don't feel like the tablet's good for much, except watching movies.
Which, when I'm on airplanes, it is good for.
Or playing games.
On the way back from Medellin, my tablet, I walked around all the city with my Nexus 7 in my bag, and I think I got smashed or something, and it didn't work. So I'm in a panic. I've got 8 hours of travel ahead. All I move. So I'm in horrible hotel Wi-Fi. I'm downloading movies and shows onto my phone and trying to get them onto my laptop, figuring out my battery power. I got there. I got enough on. And it so happened, I feared the Nexus 7 was going to be discontinued. So I bought one in 2014.
Oh, you had an extra?
I had an extra. It's been sitting there. Wow. Unused. Wow. That's how neurotic I am. And boy, did it take about 20 reloads of OS.
You hadn't used
it. But anyway, so on the trip back, I was in a panic. But that's what I really use it for a lot, is watching movies. And it's my 7-inch. It's perfect, the right size. I love it. But is it worth carrying around? That's why I'm thinking the Pixel C, if I use that as my briefcase machine when I'm out at meetings or that kind of stuff, when I'm on a plane, okay. The question is, if I'm going to be gone for a week, I probably can't take that. I've got to take a bigger machine. But if I'm gone for a day,
I also think that convertibles like the Pixel C or the Surface are more of a, I don't know, hybrid, that from a company that's just not reluctant to throw all of its eggs in any one basket. And they are not quite, I don't know, I just can't bring myself to use a device where the keyboard falls off. I just feel like it should be it should be attached.
I mean, I think my laptop's getting smaller, my phone's getting bigger, right? Like, I'd rather watch on this, you know.
Was that Nexus 6? Yeah.
Right?
iPhone 6S.
It's the Moto X Pure.
Yeah.
So, you know, with those things, I agree, like, a lot of it is for watching movies and, you know, entertainment or, you know, one app kind of things. I mean, I think to get to your point, though, Leo, is that the thing is people use us, most people use a small number of apps, 3 to 5,
right.
I think is the average.
Right.
And so if you only use 3 to 5 apps, then tablets are kind of almost there for you to be able to do a lot of what you're doing. Or a Chromebook, same thing. You know, you can do a lot of what you do if you're only doing sort of, you know, you spend most of your time on 3 to 5 different things. But more and more, as sort of the phones get bigger, have gotten bigger, all of a sudden we realize, you know, it's good enough to sort of do most of the stuff on that. And it's always with you and you're logged in and you have it, relatively convenient. Battery life being one of the challenges, of course. And that's why another reason why phablets have suddenly got a lot of momentum is because they can have a lot bigger battery in one of those suckers. So I do think that tablets are getting squeezed where we are seeing a lot of use is, again, though, they're becoming more appliances. Tablets are that sort of one app, two app appliance where you go into a business and you hand it to someone at a doctor's office to fill out their sign-in information, where somebody can go into, you know, a restaurant and they can fill out and they can join your mailing list, where they can sign in and do their reward stuff. You know, with just that one app that runs all the time on the tablet.
You can do all that on a phone. And the tablet is just kind of it's a mule. It's a donkey.
It's an appliance.
So LA Unified School District very famously raised a bond to buy more than 40,000 iPads at a cost of $768 each. And the program, as you know, huge flop. They were suing Pearson, the education software company that was creating the curriculum. School system said teachers never use it. We don't use it. They were suing Apple, saying we should have never bought it. They were suing Lenovo, who had charged the company, the district, for Pearson curriculum. They've settled. And this is a very weak settlement. If you felt like you wasted your money on the billions of dollars, billion plus dollars on iPads, they're going to get $6.4 million in a settlement from Pearson. Apple has agreed to pay $4.2 million in a settlement. So most
of
that.
When they did this on Twig, I argued at the time they should have gotten Chromebooks.
Chromebooks
would have been far better.
A third the cost.
Keyboard and the whole web is there for you. Awful decision.
The amount of money doesn't make up for the damage to the district's reputation or compensate for the amount of time lost by students and educators in this misbegotten project, said a member of the independent committee that oversees school modernization and construction bonds. A big time mistake.
The mistake here was they went with a textbook company. Textbook companies are as disrupted as newspapers.
Right.
And they're trying to hold on to their own way by selling this expensive, overpriced junk to you. where when you have the whole world's knowledge organized for you by Google. Thank you, Google. All you need to do is get to it.
Teachers didn't get training. They had very limited training. The product released by Pearson, the curriculum, was apparently not very usable or very good. And it just, what a mess. What a mess. All right, let's take a break. Lots more to talk about. Andrew Cunningham is here from Ars Technica. How many words in that El Capitan review?
Boy, I'd have to go back and look, but I think it was 13 or 14,000. Not quite Syracuse-esque, but
no, I think he crossed 20,000 frequently, didn't he? Yeah.
Usually, yeah. It was like 22 or 24.
Jeez. Holy cow. Also here, Jason Heiner, thank you once again for making me the subject of the latest chapter in the Follow the Geek book. Followthegeeksbook.com. If you want to read that for the next couple of weeks, it'll be available for free. And the book will be in stores in a couple of months.
Yes, indeed. It sure will. Nice.
And Jeff Jarvis, our professor, Professor Jarvis, regular on This Week in Google. And I always want to get you on Twit. I don't do it much because I don't want to overburden you, but I do love when you join us. Thank you.
I'll take airtime anytime I can get it.
Back from Medellin, you can draw your own conclusions. You were there for a journalism conference.
Mm-hmm.
It was fun.
It was fun. Yeah. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah. For those of us who have been watching Narcos, it's not the same. It's different.
No, not at all. It's really come a long way. They're not too crazy about the show down there.
I bet they're not.
But it's the city has come through amazingly.
Don't tell me how it ends. I haven't finished the show yet. I don't know what happens.
No, I don't think it's, for what I know, I don't think it's the end. I think it just leads to more.
There's more.
I haven't finished watching either, but I'm told that, let's put it this way, if he doesn't die.
There's still more to go.
That's what I'm told.
Amazing.
I haven't watched it yet. I don't know.
Amazing.
Halfway through.
Our show today brought to you by Braintree. And if you're a mobile app developer, or you have a website and you're looking for a payments solution, do not, under any circumstances, spend the time and effort to code it yourself. That's hubris. And this is a specialized field, the crypto, the security. We know. I mean, you don't want to be the next company on the headlines, you know, Company X breached. You want to do it with somebody that knows what they're doing, and that's Braintree. Braintree, it's on Uber. That's how Uber does its payments. It's GitHub uses Braintree, Airbnb, StubHub. Everybody uses Braintree because it works. It's simple. It's secure. Payouts are fast. They've got the best support. They'll even do the integration for you. It's simple, though. 10 lines of code, and suddenly you could take credit cards. You could take Venmo, PayPal. You could take Apple Pay. You could take Android Pay. You could take even take Bitcoin, and it's all handled for you. It's just so slick. You'll see fewer abandoned carts, more sales with Braintree's best-in-class mobile checkout experience. The one-touch SDK means that it's... You used it. You used it with Uber. When you took an Uber and you got out of the car and you didn't pay anything, boom, that's one-touch. If you use Pinterest, they're doing it on Pinterest now with the buyable pins. Have you seen the buyable pins on Pinterest? That's Braintree. Braintree's kind of... slick. It's sweet. If you're a developer or if you're running a project and you need a full stack payment solution with a simple, easy integration across all platforms, superior fraud protection, great customer service for you and your customers, fast payouts, braintreepayments.com/twit. And a little sweetener here, your first $50,000 in transactions are fee free. That's nice. braintreepayments.com/twit. I guess it would be remiss of me not to mention and pass along condolences to the people, the students and teachers who were killed in Oregon over the week. The tech angle on this is a little touchy, and I'm going to bring this up and I'm going to let you guys talk me off the ledge. Reason being, I just read a couple of weeks before this a study. Let me see if I can find this, from the American Psychological Association, of the impact of violent media over...
Bottom of the doc.
It's at the very bottom there? Yeah, on the impact of violent media. Here we go. Time has the article, but it comes from the American Psychological Association. It was a review of research going way back. They published this in August 2013. It was a task force. They reviewed 100 studies on violent video games, published between 2005 and 2015. They concluded playing violent video games can increase aggressive behavior and thoughts. We've always said there's no study that proves this, and yet over 100 studies show that lessening empathy and sensitivity towards aggression. Nobody's saying it turns you into a violent criminal. If it did, I would be a violent criminal, and you would be a violent criminal, and you would be. But it,
not me. I don't play him. But I'm the most violent, crazy guy here.
But I have to say, I feel like we live in a world where violence on television, on movies, and video games is so commonplace and so brutal that we have inured ourselves to it. And, you know, while there's, of course, many calls for gun control and stuff, but it is a cultural problem, and it's more than just controlling guns. And I wonder if this is something we as a technology community should consider. Or is it censorship? I'll let you start, Jeff, because I'm sure you're a First Amendment guy.
Yeah, correlation, not causation.
Right.
You take a sicko like that in Oregon, or we can name the ones every 2 weeks in this country.
But they're mostly, by the way, young men who played these games, right?
But it, believe me, the game didn't make them go out and do this.
No.
These guys had problems.
I'm going to get, listen, I know what
I'm about to say. You don't want politics in the show because I know the email you get, but I got to say it. The problem is giving these crackpots 14 guns, legal access to 14 guns. If he didn't have legal access to 14 guns, could he have taken a knife to somebody? Could he have taken his car to somebody? Yeah, but 14 guns this bozo had. 14 legally acquired guns. That's far more the problem. There are sickos, nut jobs, hate-filled idiots in the world. And the more we give them weapons, the worse that is. Video games don't make them into sickos.
But I feel like they may be training vehicles. They may teach you how to do this and to give you kind of an ideation that encourages this kind of behavior.
But it is a First Amendment issue because...
Yeah, and I don't know what to do to stop it, but maybe we need to take some responsibility. It's so easy to blame guns, but maybe it's a larger... It's not just... I agree it's guns, but it's not just guns.
Before that, it was television. Before that, it was movies, right? And if you watch, give me a violent movie. What's his name? Who's the crazy guy who did
Tarantino?
Thank you, Tarantino. right. So should we ban Tarantino? Should we outlaw?
He has
Tarantino?
The right to make those. I would.
Of course, he does. Yeah. And does that turn people? Even if it inspires one person, supposedly inspires. Even if there are similarities. Even if the sicko admired that movie, it is absolutely a case of correlation, not causation. There's absolutely no real scientific proof that says this is going to make someone do what they do. These people are sick beyond sick, violent beyond violent, murderers as murderers, and no silly, no TV show, no book, no movie, no video game. None of that is going to make them do what they do. And I refuse to get caught in the trap where we start saying this. And, you know, this goes back to Tipper Gore and music. Music was going to make you do horrible things. Music was going to make you kill the cops. Every single media that comes out, somebody wants to control it. And that is, thank God, why we have a First Amendment. And at the end of the day, if you think that people are such incredible sheeple that they can be changed by these things, then you're right, Leo. You already would have killed 100 people.
Yeah, I don't think it makes you a killer. I think it inures you to violence. I think we are so bathed in violence on television and movies. And I agree. I'm not suggesting that we censor. But maybe self-censorship.
It's the latest medium. I mean, really, it happened when movies were violent and there were efforts to control that. It happened with TV shows. Oh my God, this is going to ruin civilization. It happened with music, and now it's happening with video games. And I don't think it's ever been shown that media have this real impact. And you can say that it makes us empathetic, but again, is that correlation or causation? Who is drawn to video games but people who have no life? Right. Sorry, just a joke, guys. Just a joke. I don't love video games. Just a joke.
I like video games.
Right? I mean, so who's to say? Again, you can't argue causation.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, it was interesting. I was watching an old episode of The West Wing not long ago, and they went through this big argument, you know, among the whole White House staff, right, in this episode. And they're saying, what are we doing? They're like, we're talking about gun control on Tuesday, and on Wednesday, we're going to this big Hollywood fundraiser from this guy that makes all these violent movies. And the one person on the staff is like saying, this is ridiculous. Like, how can we be talking about, you know, violence, and then the next day we're taking money from this person that's glorifying violence. And they didn't really come to a conclusion, but it's the same. They were having exactly these same arguments, right? The point is it wasn't just video games. It was also media.
We're bathed in violence all the time. And I just don't, I can't believe that doesn't have an impact on
like,
us.
Does it glorify? I mean, you sort of have to come back. I agree. Like, it should not be legislated. Between the First Amendment and the Second Amendment, it's very difficult to think of a scenario where we could legislate it anyway.
No, you can't. And I wouldn't want that. I mean, everybody has a right to do their art. But I would like people to consider maybe the impact of their art and what.
Let me do it.
There are very few nonviolent video games. Almost all video games are about killing.
I saw the Emily Blunt movie last night. You know, it's a violent movie. That's part of what it is. Let me do the devil's advocate to what I know you're doing is devil advocating right now.
I'm not actually. I'm really kind of serious about this.
But let me do a devil's advocate anyway.
Okay.
I would argue that if we become too controlling and too protecting, we take people away from the judgments they have to make, understanding fact from fiction, understanding fantasy from not. There's a woman named Lenore Skenazy in New York, who I used to work with her at the Daily News, who wrote a book called Free Range Children, Free Range Kids. Mm-hmm. She got into all kinds of crap because she let her 8-year-old ride the New York subway. Say, kid, go out and learn the world. It's okay. People just went crazy. And the overprotection that I think we do of our children and of society, the nurturing and nannying, I would argue in the long run is more harmful because you will encounter bad people. You will encounter violent urges. You will encounter anger. You will encounter these things. And you need to be equipped to know how to control those things and to know what is just play or what is just release and what is reality. Now, the sick Fs who've done what they've done obviously do not have that ability. But they didn't have that ability anyway. And this certainly wasn't going to push them. And a normal person learns those things. And it's not a bad influence, I think, to have these ranges of life and good and bad in front of you. If you try to control everything too much, you probably hurt the mature decision-making of society in the long run.
Do you want to weigh in on this, Andrew, or are you wisely staying away?
I think I mostly agree with Jeff on the issue. I think that guns are a big part of it. I mean, you have video games, you have violent media, you have all this stuff in other countries, and yet this is the one where this kind of stuff happens with this kind of regularity. And yeah,
I'm not anti-gun control. I'm not working for the NRA, but it seems like a simplistic fix. I know it worked in Australia. I know it works in other countries. But it doesn't it only addresses like this kind of physical manifestation. But what caused the rage? What caused the anger? It feels like it's got to be more than just say, well, if you didn't have guns, you wouldn't have this problem. You mean these people wouldn't be sick and angry and find other weapons?
Well, I mean, there are weapons and then there are guns. You know, we're talking about knives before. Yeah. You could kill people with knives, but
it's slower,
makes it harder,
and it's a little messier
to kill as many. And it's a whole different sort of thing. And, you know, talking about this specific
Switzerland, gun ownership is almost universal. They don't see these same rates of mass murders, nowhere near it.
Yeah, I mean, there aren't simple answers, and that's what I mean.
I feel like
that's a weaselly cop-out, but it's true. I mean, this piece tries to make this link specifically between video games and violence, but how do you, like, isolate video games by themselves
maybe
to do
the issue
in the first place.
Maybe the issue is we don't know how to treat mental illness very well. Maybe the issue is, I mean, there could be a lot more to this.
It's that issue, and guns. Yeah. The two are obviously a lethal combination.
It's also, you know, there is no society in the world or in sort of the history of humanity like America, right? There's no place on Earth where you have so many different people, so many different kinds of people put together, living next to each other, having to coexist, and that have, you know, lots of differences that really are only bound together, not by ethnicity, not by geography, but by this idea, right, of a country where that's based on sort of a certain amount of freedoms. And you have all these different kinds of people, you have all these different kinds of backgrounds, and they're living next to one another, and they have all of these freedoms. And so in some sense, we should not be surprised that it's the most violent society on Earth, which essentially it is, you know, going, if you look at gun deaths. Whereas these other places like Sweden, you know, like other places, they are very homogenous societies, right? Most nations in the world are very homogenous societies, or they have two or three different types of groups, and often those two or three different types of groups, you know, are committing, sadly, crimes against one another and having to deal with, you know, centuries-old debates. You know, here, this is still, America is, even though it's 300 years old, you know, that's just a blip on the radar, right? This is still an experiment in trying to understand how can you bring so many different types of people together and figure out how to live together and build a good society and deal with all of these kinds of things. Have freedoms, but also have security, also have safety, you know. And these are part of the growing pains of building this kind of society. And we still haven't figured it out, right? There's still a lot of things we have to figure out. And this is one of the biggest ones. And there aren't any easy answers. But like, I think the worst thing we can do is throw our hands up and say, yes, you know, it just happens here.
I agree. We got to find out. And I guess that's where this conversation came from. That and the fact that in the first 4 months of this year, Australia banned 220 video games in 4 months, including Douchebag Beach Club, Drunk Driver, and Hobo Simulator.
But they wouldn't do that to God. If you had a video game that endorsed and explained and instructed in absolutely everything, a book that did everything the video game did, we wouldn't think of banning the book. That would be Godwin's law time.
Yeah.
Right?
No, book banning is different, isn't it? Books, yeah, but not video games, because they're not considered art and expression.
Or TV shows.
Yeah. All right. I realize I'm being a caveman in this, but it bothers me. I feel like, I mean, clearly we've got to find it. We've got to find a solution to this, right?
And no, you're not finding a caveman. Being a caveman, Leo, I think you're doing the right thing. It's like, we have to have dialogue. We have to figure, you know, we have to throw out different solutions. We have to figure it out, because that's part of living in a free society, a multicultural society like this. Is we're facing, you know, unprecedented challenges and these kinds of things, and we have to have dialogue to work through it.
I see a lot of kids spending 7 or 8 hours a day in front of screens of various kinds. Some of them it's video games, some of it's TV as well. A lot of it's very violent, and I just can't believe that doesn't have an impact. I'm not saying I know what the solution is, but.
Well, you raised the 2 points, and again, I don't want to get in trouble with letter writers and tweeters.
Oh, I don't care. I get the letters no matter what, so it doesn't really, point, right? Doesn't really
the
matter.
The obvious hanging fruit here is mental health care and guns and the combination of the two.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think we need to. I think we need to make a more civil society. I really do.
Yeah.
I don't know how you. I have no idea how you do that.
Part of the way you teach people that is by showing them extremes, and having them build the judgment to deal with that.
Yeah.
I think that we've become far too protective. And I know I'm sounding like a libertarian there. I'm a Hillary Clinton Democrat, so you can attack me on that if you want to. I think we've become, you know, nanny state. I come to agree with now, and I think Lenore Skenazy is right. I think our children became too protected, so they didn't have as much ability to judge. You know, we scheduled every minute. We put a cocoon around them, and I'm not sure that's the right thing to do.
In 1956, I love this link from the chat room. Santa Cruz banned rock and roll.
Yep.
for much the same reason, by the way. The music was detrimental to both the health and morals of our youth and community. The ban was issued following a raid on a dance hall at the local civic center, where officers claimed teenagers were engaged in, quote, obscene, abandoned, and highly suggestive dancing to the provocative rhythms of an all-Negro band. This thing can only lead to juvenile delinquency and degeneracy and will not be tolerated in the city of Santa Cruz. Now, I went to Santa Cruz High 15 years later, and things had changed quite a bit. But in 1956, we have a problem with rock and roll in children.
Could you imagine if you could have airdropped them into like the 1990s, like hip hop or something?
I think if anybody from 20 years ago or 30 or 40 or 50, in this case years ago, would be horrified if they came here and they turned on the TV and they saw the games. The games, by the way, they're very, very real and vivid. They're much more so than they were even a few years ago. And now, one of the reasons this kind of came to mind is I was watching the Bullet Train demo at the Oculus Rift. This is a VR game where I'll show you. If this doesn't scare you a little bit, then I don't know what will. This is from Epic. Let's see. That's not it. Let me. That's actually the actual bullet train.
What you're getting at, Leo, is the real issue is with people that make these things, right? And
well,
you know,
I'm not going to tell them not to. But watch. This is pretty violent. So, but some people say, "Oh, this is the greatest game ever."
Be alert. The enemy will be waiting for you.
And this is, by the way, in virtual reality. So you're in this environment. And then I watch this, and a week later, I hear about what happened in Oregon, and I just feel like, gosh darn it, can't we do better?
But you're making a correlation there that you have no evidence, no proof of the causation.
Okay.
That linkage is critical. Because just because they happen at the same time doesn't mean...
No. I don't think he was even playing this game. It's not available yet. It's not it at all.
Well, I'm saying that
I feel like there's a cultural thing going on somehow in this country. I just worry about it. As we all should.
It's the idea of being frustrated, right? There are lots of frustrations in modern life, in modern society. And, you know, the conclusion is can you... get rid of those frustrations with violence, right? That's one of the options. That's one of the alternatives and that too many people, especially in America, are taking. Yeah. And how do we stop that? How do we change that? And,
all right. Good question. Very hard question. And maybe there's nothing will happen because we can't solve this and we'll just see what happens. We're going to take a break. I'm sorry to have brought up such a downer.
Important job, stuff. Leo.
Well,
you're the downer.
I only say that because it's traditional in tech media. Never, it's considered never to be done in any way. Criticize violence in video games. It's just. But I just wanted to maybe take a chance.
There's one more. There is a different way in which as a responsible game maker, you define responsibility. And yes, you need to do that. I won't want government doing it for us. I don't want it done externally. But you can decide what you think is good and bad. And as a company that produces them, you can decide what is good and bad. As a publisher, you don't necessarily publish. You don't publish everything that comes to you. And everyone along the chain can make their own responsible decisions. And that discussion is important. And I agree with that.
Yeah.
But the answer to this is not to say, let's now control that process. Let's improve that process.
Agree. Mm-hmm. Completely.
And just in case you were wondering, here's a video of a Japanese live streamer accidentally burning down his house on Twitch while streaming a game on Twitch. And you could watch this live.
Boy.
Jesus.
On twitch.tv.
Oh, no.
I know.
We should ban Twitch then. Twitch burns down houses.
Twitch causes fires. He's pouring water from his soda bottle on this.
This poor dude.
I think it actually gets worse as you go along.
Oh, Jesus.
Anyway, I'm sorry.
Holy.
You see, I told you they're dangerous. I want to talk about Amazon doing something kind of stunning, and I hope you all can explain why they did this.
Yeah, let's get serious.
Let's get serious. Something more important. But first, let me tell you how to use your time more effectively with Stamps.com. Stamps.com just crossed a big milestone. $1.5 billion in postage printed by Stamps.com customers. And I think a lot of times we do this ad and that people think, oh, I'm not a big enough business. It's not for me. You know, even a small business is going to benefit from Stamps.com. You don't want to go to the post office. If you're a sole proprietor, you can't take time to wait in line at the post office. And here come the holidays and it's going to be more time spent looking for parking. When you can do it all at your desk with Stamps.com. And you don't need a postage meter. Sometimes people think, oh, you mean like Pitney? No, this is not a postage meter. This is so much less. Did you know, I just found this out. Postage meter ink costs 1,000 times more than inkjet ink, which costs more than anything I know. You don't need a postage meter. Your computer and printer are all you need, and Stamps.com. You'll save at least 50% compared to a postage meter. You won't have to waste time going to the post office. You'll even get discounts you cannot get at the post office. And you can get discounted package insurance in just one click. No more handwritten forms. You print it out, certified mail, return receipt, international customs forms, all automatically filled out by the software. This makes your business, big or small, look more professional. And that's what you want. And it's not just for letters. It's for any size package. It's for anything that you're sending. And you don't even have to go to the post office because the mail carrier will come to you, pick it up, take it to the post office for you. Stamps.com. If you do any kind of mailing in your business, however big or small, you really ought to look at this. It's just the best. Sign up right now. We have a special promo code. If you click the microphone in the upper right-hand corner, you'll get a four-week trial and a $110 bonus offer when you use the offer code TWIT, T-W-I-T. You'll get $55 in postage coupons, a free digital scale, $5 supply kit. You pay postage and handling on a scale for about $5, and a month of stamps.com. It's awesome. We use it here at the office. All our mailings look pro. Yours can too. Stamps.com. Click the microphone in the upper right-hand corner and use the promo code TWIT, T-W-I-T. Amazon says, we are not going to sell Apple's new TV. We are not going to sell Google's new TV, video streaming devices. We are banning them from Amazon because, of course, Amazon has a competing device, but I always thought Amazon was a retailer. Yeah. Maybe not.
Man, this is a bad move. It also makes me feel like, one, Amazon could sell lots of those other devices, right? Because
what business are they in?
Yeah, yeah.
They say they won't sell them because those platforms don't have Amazon's Prime Video app on them. Well, whose fault is that?
Right, yeah. That was my immediate reaction was that, in literally a month, we'll have an Apple TV where the only thing standing between Amazon and a Prime app on Apple TV is Amazon. And I think on the Chromecast, that's already the case. Like, they could, in theory, develop one and have it work great, and they just have opted not to do that.
You could make a case that maybe Apple's keeping Amazon streaming video out of the App Store or off the TV. You could make that case, but you can't make that case with Chromecast because anybody can develop a Chromecast app with a Chromecast button. Google doesn't have to give you permission.
Google, it gets accused of antitrust behavior and marketplace behavior when it's not. Google opens up these things and enables, and I think it's shameful behavior on Amazon's part.
It's a bad sign for the future of internet TV, too, that these things are going to become these entrenched, kind of three-way platform war, which is bad.
We don't need more silos.
Consumers.
We don't need
this. Man, it's so bad for consumers, right? You don't want to have to have, two or three devices just to get, this mix of content that you already have or, so it's just a bad sign for the future of internet TV. That's what bummed me out the most about it was like, oh, great. Now we're into this real three-way platform war. Whereas Amazon really had the best chance of being the one player who played across all these platforms, right? Which could have really helped them, I think, which could have ultimately sold more devices for them in the long run. But it was just a dumb move on their part.
Yeah, I mean, that's the reason that I use Kindle for ebooks instead of anything else is because I can get that on my iPhone and iPad and Nexus and Windows and like every other device that I can think of. I can read those books. And I wanted them to keep doing that with Prime. I wanted them to keep being like the neutral party, but apparently they've decided that they're another one of those companies that needs to be all things to all people.
Frecklish in the chat room points out that Amazon's always said customer comes first. We're customer obsessed. We're customer focused. Well,
they sell from competitors like crazy. they show you the prices of people who are selling things at lower prices. They give you tons of options. Yet here,
obviously, they're not customer obsessed. They're Amazon's streaming.
This is a discussion that you and I have had often, Leo, about where you argue that Google's in the content business. I argue they're not yet, but Amazon is most certainly in the content business.
Suddenly, it's provably true.
Yes.
Is it possible, though, Andrew, that Amazon wants Amazon streaming to be available on Chromecast and Apple, and there's some technical reason that they can't do that? Is it possibly not their fault?
I mean, if HBO can do it, who can't do it? Like, I'm struggling to think of other video services that want to be available on these platforms that can't for some technical reason. Like, if they really wanted to, I think that they could get there.
It seems very odd that they're blaming that. they're saying, well, we don't want to sell anything that doesn't carry our service. But isn't it you that's preventing that?
I mean, they have an iOS app. They have an iOS app, and tvOS is just iOS. It's right. The same underlying operating system on both devices. So I don't understand what the technical barrier is. I mean, I think this is pretty obviously a scapegoat reason, and they just don't want to sell these things that are competing with their own devices.
One of the number one things I've wanted all along is to have Amazon streaming on my Chromecast, because then everything I want would be on it. Everything I need would be on it. Showtime's on it now. HBO's on it. Netflix, of course. Hulu Plus. If they would just add Chromecast to the Amazon video app, I'd be so happy. And apparently, that's never going to happen now. And it's like Betamax versus VHS. The consumer's going to be stuck between two unmovable objects.
It could deepen. This is one of those moves that could deepen the line. The lines were already starting to be drawn, right? And this could sort of deepen some of those lines. I don't know. Like Jeff said, you know, Google has maintained openness here, and hopefully they'll continue to. You know, Apple, of course, is on the other end of the spectrum. You know, completely closed. Probably it's not out of this. Out of the realm of conceivability that they're sort of blocking an Android app or whatever, potentially. But what we've talked about on the show before, even if Amazon did do it, you know, it would probably be less fully featured. And, you know, Amazon's not going to want to give Apple a percentage of its content like Apple makes you do, you know, give you 30% of sales. So even if there was an app, it was likely to be one of those things where you have to buy your content outside of the app and then, you know, bring it in. And that's not necessarily a terrific experience. So maybe this was academic, you know, maybe this was one of those things that, you know, was destined to happen. But Amazon just had the chance to be that one platform content provider that was going to play across, you know, different ecosystems. So that's why I think this matters. And it does matter because, you know, internet TV is coming on strong, and it's going to be big, big business. I understand why they did it, because this platform thing, as a content provider, is a multi-billion-dollar opportunity, right? And they essentially are choosing that multi-billion-dollar opportunity ahead of sort of being the one that just makes the sort of nickels and dimes off of pieces of content that they're selling everywhere.
You know who really benefits is not Amazon, but Roku. Seems like it's just, yeah.
Wow.
Well, okay, so the only thing that you can't do on any of these devices except an Apple TV is iTunes, right? And Apple makes sure of that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
But you can do everything else except Apple on a Roku, right?
Yeah.
Can you do anything else on Amazon's Fire platform?
I can't. Almost.
I'm not sure. I feel like Roku is now the most complete offering, and all Amazon's doing is throwing business to Roku. By the way, of course, you could still buy Google stuff from Google and Apple stuff from Apple and other retailers as well. It's not like it's somehow going to prevent people from buying it. It just feels a little petty and weird.
But once you're in there, you know, you're just locked in more than ever, right? If you start buying, you know, your stuff from Google or Apple or Amazon now, you know, you're more than likely stuck, you know, there because, you know, if you move to one of the other ones, you're not going to be able to get your stuff. Now, you could move from, you know, Fire TV potentially to Roku or to Chromecast, but not to Apple TV. But, you know, with the lines being drawn between these platforms, I don't know. I do think to get to the Roku question, I do think that I have Roku.
Roku's number one right now, 34% market share.
It is. Wow. It is.
Yeah.
I do think that Amazon Fire TV is much easier to use than a Roku. Roku's what I used to recommend to, you know, sort of people that weren't in this already and were just looking for some kind of
Roku internet connect looks box. like the neutral player now. Right?
That's true. I see. So that's why you're saying it helps.
Yeah,
Roku,
I feel like it looks like Roku looks like the most grown up of the bunch.
Yeah, that's true. But Amazon Fire TV is much easier to use. Of all these
devices. I have
devices,
one. I've never installed it. It's sitting on the shelf.
I have them all. Their voice activation is really good. Yeah. They've done some good work with the voice. You can just click that microphone button and, you know, talk to it, and it works
remarkably well. It makes
me mad
that companies sacrifice customers' interests to create these siloed environments. And, you know, you look at, contrast this to Microsoft, which used to do that, and now just says, we're going to put our apps everywhere our customers are. We don't care that it's on an iPad.
Desperation is the mother of generosity.
Right. Yeah, I was just going to say, like, the thing that Roku does not have that Apple, Google, Amazon have is, like, something else that it does. So, like, it can't afford to make anybody upset.
They're
so
agnostic.
It's not going to play these games.
And Roku does have voice search. It's not as good. Apple's TV's voice search will probably be the best when it comes out, I'm guessing.
I think you're all hitting the really important part, which is a change in the ecology of distribution.
Yes.
We're seeing this on the text side. You know, instant articles allows you to go to where the readers are. Google this week, according to Recode, I can't say anything more, but I'll be there when they announce whatever that Recode said they're going to announce, is going to enable easier distribution of kind of news content and other web content. You got to go to where the readers are. You got to go where the viewers are. You have to go where the people are, rather than always making them come to you. What's missing, though, in all of these structures is, and I think I've talked about a company called Repost before, where if you make content embeddable, the benefit is, oh, free content. You can embed free content. But what we don't do is we don't value the creation of the audience. We don't share revenue at that level too. And if we did, if we had a marketplace both for the creation of content and for the creation of audience, then it can find its own water level. Then you can do deals and say, okay, so if you bring us enough audience, says Amazon, great. I'd love to have your app there. But Amazon still controls too much about saying, well, because we own the content, that's where the value is. No, there's a lot of other people who will be happy to distribute the Amazon content, and there's a deal to be done.
So is Amazon short-sighted doing this? Are they not?
I think so. I mean, Bezos sees it because obviously he had to authorize the fact that the Washington Post and the paper he owns is going to put all of its content onto Facebook.
Right.
And there's a benefit there, but he's going to make money on it because there's going to be ads there, there's new distribution there, there's new value there. And I don't know what else was done to get that super deal done between Washington Post and Facebook. We're still trying to keep an old siloed media world where you had to go to the theater, you had control over things. And as it shifts, and I think it shifts pretty radically, and I'll be able to talk about this more on Wednesday on Twig, we'll see a lot more unusual deals about audience, I think.
Speaking of the Washington Post, I think they got a little suckered. That's probably a good word. By People. We're still not sure about this. This is the Yelp for People. The idea is it's an app they say will come out next month. Julia Cordray, one of the app's founders, says people do so much research when they buy a car, make these kinds of decisions. Why not do the same kind of research on other aspects of your life? It's a Yelp for People in which you can take somebody, as long as you know their cell phone number, and rate them online. Her co-founder, Nicole McCullough, says, as a mother of two in an era when people don't always know their neighbors, she wanted something to help her decide whom to trust with their kids. A horrified article by Caitlin Dewey in the Washington Post in the Intersect column. Shocking. She even said, oh, people won't be able to remove their names. There'll be no right to be forgotten. And, of course, you can. It doesn't take much to imagine a horrific outcome to PEEPLE, except a number of people think this isn't even an app, that there never was an intent to make an app. And that Julia Cordray and her co-founder were just making this up. For attention, Nicole McCullough. Snopes even tried to get to the bottom of this. Snopes.com, where they debunk rumors, couldn't prove that it was a hoax, but they kind of feel like there's a lot of evidence, including the date April 1st on its Twitter page, which has since been removed, that this was a joke. They didn't mention the platform. They didn't say, is it Android? Is it iOS? Where it's going to come out?
Well, fine. Let's go build it.
What do you think? maybe they want somebody to do this, and they're trying to get somebody to do it. Anyway, if you read the Snopes article, I have to say, it feels like the Washington Post maybe was hornswoggled, sucker punched, fooled by these two. Let's take a break. We have more coming up. Lots more to talk about. Andrew Cunningham from Ars Technica is here. We'll talk about El Capitan. El Capitan, which came out this week.
I looked it up. It's 16,000 words.
Oh,
I was
nice.
Off
well done.
A couple thousand. Yeah.
Well done. Bravo. Also, how many words are in the book? Meet the Geeks. Jason.
Wild Geeks? Yeah. It'll be about 75,000 words.
Jeez. You know, Renee Ritchie told us on Mac Break Weekly that he's crossed a million words in articles for, it was like 4 million words in articles for iMore. Crazy.
Wow.
You guys must have blisters on your fingers. I don't understand.
You just stop noticing after a while. You get good, nice big calluses.
You know, I hate writing so much. I've written a bunch of books, and I just hate it so much that I never will do it again. Because talking is so much easier. Jeff, you've written how many thousands of words?
Yeah, oh, God. I hate to think on blogs and stuff, but yeah.
How do you do it?
I've slowed down. Well, I've slowed down a lot. Twitter ruined me.
Yeah.
I can get rid of a thought on Twitter and it's gone and ruined me.
Twitter's ruining a lot of things.
It really is. forget these violent games. It's Twitter's fault. It's all Twitter's fault.
It might be Twitter's fault. It's true.
On a bad night, occasionally, I will believe that, actually. We're going to take a break. Come back with lots more. Great panel. Lots to talk about. Our show today brought to you by Audible.com. Audiobooks. You know, when the world gets to be too much, I just escape into my book. On Audible, you can find 180,000 soon to be your books. And as wonderful as reading is, it's even more immersive to listen. And you're listening to the same content, the same words that are in the printed book, but you're listening while you're doing other things you couldn't hold a book while you're doing, things like walking the dog, commuting in the car, washing the dishes, working out. Audible's so great for my workouts. Sometimes I'll even go a little farther because I'm listening to something and I don't want to stop. I'm just now starting a new book. I've mentioned a couple of times, a science fiction book that is by a Chinese science fiction author unknown in the West until now that people are raving about, called The Three-Body Problem. If you like science fiction, this is great. I'll tell you what, I'm going to get you two books for free. You can get the first two volumes of this trilogy for free. But there's so much more. There's mysteries. There's nonfiction. I listen to a lot of nonfiction. Just finished Season of the Witch, David Talbot's story of the history of San Francisco in the 60s and 70s. You were there that time, Jeff Jarvis. I think you would enjoy this book. And I'm sure you know David Talbot, founder of Slate. It's really a good book, really well written. And if, you know, a story, I was living in the city, the stuff that happened, I'd forgotten. So much great stuff from Patty Hearst.
Four things I've read on Audible.
What are the four things you've read on Audible?
What Would Google Do? Public Parts.
books?
I've read out loud.
You've actually read them.
I've recorded them, yes.
Is Geeks Bearing Gifts? That's on there, isn't it?
Bearing Gifts and Gutenberg the Geek.
And Gutenberg. So, golly, just search for Jeff Jarvis, and you can listen to his...
As if you haven't heard enough of me here, you can hear more of me.
Yeah.
Here.
Look, even the cover of What Would Google Do has you on the front of it. Like peering out.
Very strange.
One of the 100 worldwide media leaders. Oh, this is a discussion.
Oh, is that what?
This is
that
recorded at Books Inc. in Mountain View.
Oh, that's weird. I didn't know that was there.
There's all. You know what? The neat thing about Audible is it's not just books. There's all sorts of stuff in here. But I don't know why. There's another Jarvis, J.L. Jarvis, who apparently writes romance novels. Like
now you've found my secret out, Leo.
It's the same guy.
Jeff L. Jarvis.
Pseudonym.
Mackenzie Cooper has had it with romance. On her way home from another blind date arranged by her well-meaning sister, she's caught in a snowstorm. While maneuvering the twists and turns of the icy road, she loses control of her car. I don't know why I'm doing this in a Scottish accent.
I don't know why you are either.
and crashes into the rocky Scotsman. Hillside. When a rugged Scotsman pulls her to safety, Mackenzie is sure she must be hallucinating. There's nothing more romantic than a guy in a skirt, in a plaid skirt. He's a Highlander from 18th century Scotland, and he kisses like a madman.
Leo, I've got a killer Audible recommendation.
Oh, good. What do you got?
Yes. So it's this book called Brief, Making a Bigger Impact by Saying Less. It's by Joseph McCormick.
It better be a short book.
Very short book.
It is. It's only like 5 hours. But I just saw this guy. There's this great event last week called Idea Festival, which is kind of like a far less expensive version of TED. Joe gave a talk there, and it's here in Louisville. It's an international event. Lots of people we know that you know that have been on the show have talked there before, like Baratunde Thurston and Molly Wood. But it's a lot of, like, it's people from NASA. It's all kinds of, innovators and artists and great, great, great folks. Ideafestival.com, you can learn more about that. But Joe was there and gave a talk, and it was one of the best talks I've ever heard at any of these events.
If I listen to this, the whole network falls apart. I'm going to write a book called Longer.
Longer?
Nice. Longer.
But everybody that even comes on your show can benefit from this, because it's about sort of the three ways we live in this age when we're just absorbing so much information, right?
Yeah.
And he talks about the fact, there's this great stat where he talks about the fact that the human brain can process about 750 words a minute, I guess it is, but we can only say about 150.
Right, that's and right.
And so a lot of times your mind wandering. It's why people speed up podcasts, speed up audiobooks, right?
Because you can understand more.
I always talk fast. So I get more in.
Get more in.
Yeah, get more in. So
this isn't Brief. This is Talk Faster.
It's more about finding ways. You have a very small, if you don't make a point quickly, people's mind wanders and they fill up that extra gap, which is other stuff.
Yeah.
And so he talks about ways to make an impact by saying less. And he talks about speaking in headlines. Wow. He talks about, email, the ways you send email, the ways that you speak to people, the ways to prepare to make your words matter more. And it's funny, at this event, almost everybody's, written a book that speaks, right? And afterwards, they're out there signing their books and, they're selling their books and stuff. After the after his was the only one that sold out in like 10 minutes.
Nice.
Like everybody ran from the audience afterwards and went to buy it, because it resonated so much with, trying to make a point, not just in, speaking like he was, but in communicating in everyday life.
It's what we teach in journalism school, right?
Yeah.
Write a lead to say what you're going to say, write the nut graph, tell people what it's about, get to the point, put the unimportant stuff at the end, let people leave if they want to, and talk very fast.
Joe McCormick, Brief, Make a Bigger Impact by Saying Less. You can get that for free. You can actually get two titles for free. Really, some of the fun of Audible is picking those two. Every month I get to pick two more, because I also have that subscription, the 2-book-a-month subscription. You'll also get the Daily Digest of the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal. And you can cancel anytime in the first 30 days, pay nothing, but that book will stay yours to keep. Before you go see The Martian, do me a favor, read The Martian. And R.C. Bray narrates this beautifully.
Really well done.
Yeah, really brings Mark Watney to life. So many good books here. It's hard to just pick two.
If I may add,
yes,
plug in here. It was also through Audible's recommendation that I got to Pimsleur and He Estudiado Español durante dos meses.
They have a lot of educational stuff. They have the great courses, there's college lectures. They have the Pimsleur stuff. And normally this is very expensive. And the fact that you can get these as part of your Audible subscription really is fantastic. So what level are you up to now in Spanish, Jeff?
3.
Good.
Halfway through 3.
That's really cool. And you just listen when you got some free time in the car?
In the car.
On the train.
I look like an idiot talking on the road.
Yeah. Ashley Vance's great book on Elon Musk, or just talking about Musk.
Yeah, that's a great book.
Ashley did
that's
a great
really
job.
That's really sad. Like the beginning of it, how bullied he was.
Yeah.
Boy, that part's really sad.
But it's a story of triumphing,
It
he really has
sure
triumphed.
Is.
Because he has no fear, And he dreams big. And it's anyway, audible.com/twit and the number 2. And when you go there, you'll be able to sign up for that 2 books a month. First 2 books free. This offer good in the U.S. and Canada. But there is Audible in every country. It's just different rules and different licenses. So check your local Audible if you're not in the U.S. or Canada. But if you're in U.S. or Canada, 2 books free. audible.com/twit2. Fear is a luxury no captain can afford. The Aeronauts Windlass, The Cinder Spires, Book 1. There's a lot of romance. There is a lot of adventure, sci-fi, and fantasy. You know, sometimes you're in the mood for that. You just want to escape. Let's see. Moving on. There's a lot of stuff to talk to. I think we've done ad blockers to death. No need to talk about it anymore. Although, Jeff, you did write a good article on saying that really the onus is on advertisers and advertising to fix this problem.
And us in media to fix advertising, but that's pretty much the bottom of it.
Yeah. And you quote Putney Swope, which is ill-remembered, but one of the great funny movies of the 60s.
It really is.
Yeah. I'd forgotten about this. By Robert Downey Sr.
Yeah.
Who is also forgotten.
Yes.
The son has eclipsed the father. Anyway, recommend the article as usual. Jeff writing on Medium, and you can see I've had a number of underlinings from people I follow on Medium, and a lot of comments too. I really like this feature of Medium, this ability to have a conversation around your words.
It makes comments much better.
Yeah, because they're right there. Yeah,
yes. Right there. Yeah, yes. This I put the same post up as a note on Facebook using the new approved note structure.
Yeah,
it doesn't have quite the functionality that Medium has yet, but it's a lot more elegant. Gives you more control than just a post.
Yeah,
and a little more permanence. So it's interesting to see where this goes.
I love it that Ev Williams underlined this. At a minimum, advertising must not annoy and must also be transparent.
You know what made me think of when I actually went with this whole conversation lately? Because obviously we've been thinking about it too.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure this impacts your bottom line. Yeah.
Absolutely. Is I do a lot of research, you know, historical. Either I've always got some kind of project, not just writing a book, you know, but sometimes other sort of history kind of project, just being a history lover. And a lot of times that ends up being one of two things. That are both fun, reading dead people's mail or looking up old newspapers.
Is that legal?
Yeah, right? That's what archives are full of.
Oh,
archives
right.
are full of dead people's mail, right? Letters, old letters. But the newspapers are the interesting part, and what's, you know, useful in this case is when you go back and you read old newspapers and you look at the advertisements, they're actually as interesting, especially from a historical perspective, as the copy.
I love them.
Right?
I love them.
Because you learn so much about what was going on at the time and what people's priorities were and what they were interested in and what sold and maybe what didn't sell. As you do about anything. And also, if you look at the ads, a lot of times they're much more personal. They're more akin to something like one of the ad reads that you do, Leo, than they are to this modern.
Right.
They're not
more
so slick. Impersonal.
Yeah, they're not so slick. They're features and benefits, and you know they're folksy and yeah.
They are, and so there's an audience. Like they know that they are delivering a message to an audience, and they're interacting with them in a more personal way in a sense. And so that's one of the elements that's missing, especially in online ads, which are much more, you can tell obviously about a numbers game. It's about, volume. And that's where we've kind of lost course and where, advertising has lost its way, especially on the internet, is that they're not about addressing an audience. They're not about providing, information. They're not about sort of engagement. They're more about volume and numbers. And so,
where do you read the old stuff? I'm looking at the Google newspaper archive, which is really fun.
It is. Also, the Library of Congress has an amazing archive of old newspapers, and those are a lot of times not the big ones, but they're the more smaller community kind of papers,
right?
As well, going back to the 1800s, early 1800s. And yeah, you can read them on Google now. Obviously, I still go to libraries and look up microfilms. There are some that, you know, haven't been digitized yet.
It's fine.
You know, I'm very thankful to the college students who spend their whole summers digitizing these things. It's a very boring job, but extremely important. And so, you know, thank you if you're an intern out there that spent this past summer digitizing newspapers. We appreciate it. So, yeah, it's super useful. And I do think it's instructive to kind of where we're at, right? And that advertising has to change. It has to, you know, become more useful again, more purposeful.
Didn't banner ads really, weren't they kind of the web's equivalent of display ads in newspapers, Jeff?
Sure.
I mean, that's kind of what they are.
Well, and billboards on the street too. Just impressions.
Right. Mm-hmm. Impressions. All right. Well, there you go. Speaking of Ev Williams, Twitter, everybody's saying now, looks like they're going to have a CEO, and it's going to be what? Jack Dorsey? That seems a little odd. Jack's, of course, one of the inventors of Twitter, and in fact, he's been twice fired as CEO of Twitter.
Third time's a charm.
Also runs Square and has said many times, I won't be CEO of Twitter unless I can be a CEO. I'm not leaving Square. The Twitter boards, of course, said many times, but we want a full-time CEO. Well, the latest, and this is from Kara Swisher, of course, who knows everything. And Kurt Wagner writing for Recode that Jack Dorsey is expected to be named the permanent Twitter CEO. Feels like Twitter is just an amusement at this point. It's just so much fun to watch this. It's not a business.
It's a horror movie. And my fear is, I think Adam Bain is much respected, much loved, a sane person in a company that desperately needs sanity. He's the chief revenue officer. My fear is they could lose him. I mean, you lose who doesn't get the job.
Yeah.
And they've already lost tons of executives through all this turmoil. And
according to the Recode, Bain is widely expected to be promoted to COO.
Yeah, well.
As a little, you know, here's a bone.
But if I'd go hire Adam in a second. I used to work with him years ago in advance. But, you know, if I'm another technology company, I'd looking for a CEO, I'd hire Adam Bain away.
Yeah. What is Twitter makes money. It's not losing money. Why is Twitter in so much trouble?
They're just under pressure to keep growing and growing and growing into infinity, right? And there are signs that growth is slowing or it's not as healthy as it needs to be. And that makes the shareholders nervous. And there you go.
Never go public, folks.
Its biggest problem as a public company for Twitter is that it's not Facebook. And, you know, Facebook is a money machine the way Google AdSense was a money machine, right? And AdWords were a money machine a decade ago, right? And Twitter is not that. Twitter is something different. It is social media, but it's a different kind of social media. And it's not necessarily something that is as easy to understand right away still as what Facebook has done. I think Twitter's done a lot of good things. I think product-wise, I think they've had some misses, but Facebook has misses all the time too. I think that they've done some good things to try to make it easier to use, to try to surface more content, to try to surface older content. And they're doing lots of good things, but I think it does have it does have certain limits in terms of audience. It's still a huge audience. It's going to continue to be really important, I think, for a long time. But it's not a money machine. It's not a money machine the way Google and Facebook were. And I don't know if it ever will be. The ad click rates, you know, click-through rates on ads on Twitter are significantly less than Facebook. It's still not a fantastic ad platform. And maybe it's part of the same discussion of how does advertising work in the modern digital world? And Facebook has kind of cracked it in much more, you know, holistically than Twitter has. Twitter's still trying to figure it out. They really haven't figured out the formula yet. And that's their problem. That's, you know, once they figure that out, and I think they probably will, you know, they'll make more money. They'll make a lot more money. I don't think it'll ever be Facebook, though.
It's so amazing because, well, there's an article by Farhad Manju in the New York Times this week, where he's talking about Twitter, in effect, saving television. I mean, who would have thought that a few years ago?
Yeah, because of live matters.
Yeah, they're talking about Scandal. Every Thursday since the show's premiere, most of the Scandal cast and crew have used Twitter to add live commentary that runs during the broadcast. And this has inspired hundreds of thousands of tweets from viewers every broadcast and has been credited with not only deepening the program's relationship with its audience, but I think probably the ratings.
When I was down in Medellin, I talked with a journalist from Chile who did an amazing all the troubles in Chile from years back, there was a dramatization of it. And so this journalistic site decided to do a fact-based version of what was going on. And they used Twitter as the show was going on to say, this is what really happened. This mm-hmm. is what really happened. Blah, 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 blah. Huge, huge success, brought tremendous attention. Twitter is an amazing tool, but it's still not the world. That's the issue.
Yeah,
he talks about Joshua Molina, who I've followed on Twitter for a long time. I really liked him in The West Wing going way back. But Molina himself says, I'm not a star. I'm a working actor. Nobody knows my name. People kind of know my face, but I don't have fans. But he says, I'm 25 plus years into my career, and it's only now because of Scandal and Twitter that people know my name and I have fans. But he's very smart. He's been using Twitter for years. He's on Vine. He's on Periscope. He is an example of an actor who's been working for 25 years, who's worked, you know, a lot, but who has now finally been able to use social media to actually crack into the top tier, right? I think that's interesting. It's not just networks and shows that benefit. It's talent, too.
Yeah, I do think Twitter needs a full-time CEO, I'll be honest. I think Twitter has some big challenges, and you know, no matter how good Jack Dorsey is, and if he is the right person for the job, there's a reason why the board wants him to be full-time CEO. Like, they have a lot of problems. They need a leader who's going to really be there and lead. And that doesn't mean that Jack Dorsey can't be the figurehead of the company, can't be
executive
chairman.
Does he have the vision? I mean, the guy's been here before. It's not like he hasn't had his voice heard at Twitter. Does he have the vision to turn Twitter into whatever it is that Twitter needs to turn into? I think it's good the way it is.
I think they need somebody. Twitter's challenges, I think are more blocking and tackling, right? Like, it needs to get product right. It needs to nail that. It needs to get, figure out advertising. I don't think it needs necessarily a huge product visionary, to push it forward. It's good doing what it's doing. It needs to do business a little better. It needs to run its operations better. And it needs a lot of attention to do that. You know, Jack Dorsey's a great leader. He's a great figurehead. I think he's amazing as the face of Twitter. I think he's amazing talking about what Twitter is and why it's great. But he can do that as executive chairman. And I think if they do have the kind of brain drain, like we're talking about at the top, and they kind of already have had some, then, you know, that ultimately could, especially with him becoming CEO, that could ultimately hurt them. You know, maybe what the best case scenario is him coming in, being full-time CEO for, for a year or two, and then bumping back up to executive chairman and whoever, you know, the COO, maybe that person, they're grooming the person for CEO to sort of take over full-time. Maybe that would give, you know, Wall Street some more confidence in Twitter while the COO runs it.
I think you're right, what you said at first, which is they need a full-time CEO.
Yeah.
And if this is just a transition to that, then Wall Street's going to be impatient. What's the strategy? Yeah, figure out your game. Get it done. I don't think anybody's against Jack necessarily, but how can you not be distracted with two companies?
Yeah, you can't.
I would imagine more of his, he has a much, much larger stake in Square than he has in Twitter.
Yeah, so when Steve Jobs.
I feel like Twitter is a success, and it baffles me that it's deemed to be in trouble, and that you've got to bring in this guy to save it. When it seems like, God, you can't go anywhere without seeing a hashtag and tweet us.
It is when you compare it to Facebook, right? That's the biggest.
Well, but Facebook is everything's a failure. I'm a failure compared to Facebook. It doesn't mean I'm in trouble. It's hard. I mean, that's a bad company to compare yourself to. They have a billion and a half users.
I couldn't agree more. Yeah. I couldn't agree more, right? Nothing is Facebook or will be for some time. But Twitter's never...
Wall Street's the problem, isn't it? That's really the problem. These guys expect too much from companies. companies.
Well, Wall Street is people, right? Wall Street is investors. Wall Street is people that believe that invest in things based on what they think the future is. And people look at the future of Twitter right now, and they're not real sure, and for good reason. And I think when you look at the future of a company like Facebook or Google, you know, you're pretty certain they're going to be around in 5 or 10 years and probably making a lot more money than they are now. Twitter, it's hard to see, and I think that's why Wall Street isn't sure what to think about them. And I think we all agree it's going to be around, but I think even we're not sure, you know, how will it change? How will it, you know, make more money? And I think Dorsey, he's gonna, you know, even if you're the CEO of two companies, like, it's hard to do it equally. You know, when Jobs was the head of Apple and Pixar, he was dedicating most of his time to Apple. He had people at Pixar that were already, by the time he was doing that, he had people that were running Pixar. And he was making executive decisions, and his job was to go in and punch people in the nose in Hollywood and you know, make sure that they got a good deal. And he was really great at it. And other than that, he didn't really run the company. You know, other people ran the company.
Aren't Twitter doing like a news thing? Everybody's doing a news thing. That's a safe thing to ask. Everybody's doing a news thing. What is Twitter's... It's curated.
It's curated. And things are... Again,
it's not what people want from Twitter, is it?
What the board says what the market says is, you're not big enough, Twitter, so clearly you're not giving people what they want. So what do they want? Figure it out and give it to them. So now they flail around trying to figure out what that thing could be. Is it longer tweets? Is it curated people? Is it curated content? You know, the rumors of what's coming out this week from Google that have been published on Recode, I think could make a huge difference in the way you experience content through links in a place like Twitter. I think a lot could change around Twitter. But the problem is that you see it as a success, but the market doesn't.
Yeah.
Yeah, but is that really, I guess we have to run the world that way because they're a public company, and if their stock tanks, they can't hire people, and then the whole thing spirals down. But
I mean, I brought a bunch of German editors and publishers into places like Vox and Quartz and other places like that, and every time I brought them in, one of the people at those companies would say, I know you're all on Twitter, but they point out the window, they're all on Facebook.
Yeah.
And in a media world, that's what you're paying attention to. And Facebook has so much more data about you. It knows more about you. It can target amazingly. Now you have Google adding the new function that enables marketers to give them their email address list so that even through Google, you're going to be able to target directly. I've argued that the real industry these folks are in is signals. And it's a war of signals. And Facebook has a tremendous war chest of signals, that is to say data about people.
Yeah.
Google has tremendous mechanisms like Android to gather signals about you. Amazon has tons of signals about you. Apple less so, and Apple also is not really in the ad business, so they don't really need it as much. But those three companies, Facebook, Google, and to an extent, Amazon, in the advertising world, they have the wealth of signals. We in media have been stupid. We don't have relationships with people, so we don't have those signals. And Twitter, it has some signals, but Gina Trapani knows as much more about you than Twitter does.
Isn't that funny? Yeah.
They're not really using it well.
Think up. Yeah.
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 We lost you, Andrew, but I think we got you back.
Yeah, I've been told that I'm back.
You're back. Is there anything you wanted to add to that?
No, we were talking about Facebook and Google earlier, and I think the interesting thing about those two companies is that they've proven that they can change and grow and get into new things successfully over like the last decade and a half. Whereas Twitter, like, they've got that one core product. And if, like, even when they try to change anything about it, like if they change the stars to hearts or if they increase the number of characters in a DM, like people go, the established users of that service go kind of crazy about it in a bad way. And so that's another thing they've got to fight too as they look to grow is like, how do they do that without alienating the people who are already there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're talking about increasing the 140 character limit. I don't know what you get, though, if you do that with Twitter. It's not Twitter anymore.
That's its secret sauce, right? Like,
right.
You know, that's why Twitter's Twitter.
Why can't it just be a little small business, go along, have 300 million users, just be happy?
Because you're a public company. When you're a public company, right? The law of gravity is different when you're a public company.
Yeah, I guess.
Let's emphasize how far they came. I remember that I made a friend of Fred Wilson when he invested in it, saying, "You know, where's the business model? There's no business model there, Fred." And indeed, it is profitable. And Dick Costolo did grow the revenue and grow the company impressively, with a hard hand, and it needed it. But it's still, I mean, you know, the problem is you just can't count on what Twitter is going to be. I still am nervous about them based on the way they treated developers back in the day. They grew on the backs of developers.
Yeah.
Then they kicked the developers in said backs.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
And
just to prove your point, by the way, Andrew, Ken from Chicago just in the chat room said, "No, I hate the Twitter redesign of stars to hearts. I hate it." I think that's good. When your users care that much about something like that, that means that they love you.
Yeah.
That's what I tell myself every morning when I read my Twitter feed.
My preferred Twitter clients are all the ones that make Twitter act like it did, like in 2010. So if I'm the typical user of your service, like, yeah, I think you've got some problems. That's how change resistant
I use the mute button liberally, and I'll mute somebody, and then they don't know I've muted them, and I just don't see them anymore, and life goes on. It's a wonderful thing. Mm-hmm. Your stream can be so nice, so pleasant. Let us take a break, come back with more. Kind of the back of the book, the silly stories, Japanese autonomous cabs, things like that. First, though, let's talk about disaster. You never know when disaster will strike. At work or at home, storm, fire, flood, or Joey in the stockroom accidentally deleting the entire hard drive could put you out of business. You got to back up. It drives me crazy on the radio show, especially I'm on the front lines of this. Guy called today. Said, "I have some legal documents on a USB thumb drive, and I can't read it." And I said, "Didn't you have a backup?" He said, "Yeah, I had a backup, but I can't read that either." I said, "You need Carbonite, for crying out loud. How many times do I have to tell you? Carbonite backup for business and home. 1.5 million folks have finally heard the word. Maybe you should, too. Back it up. You install Carbonite once. You could forget about it. Anytime you're online, it's automatically backing up. It's encrypted on the way to the server, encrypted in place on the server, but your data is there. It's safe. It's like a data vacation. It's in there in the Carbonite Climate Controlled Network Operations Center, where breezes blow across it and it gets to relax and enjoy. Probably you have even a little tropical drink in its hand. But when you need it back, when you've got to get it, you just press the restore button. There's your stuff back to work. You don't miss a beat. Use our offer code TWIT. You'll get 2 free months when you buy. You've heard me talk about this. I know you have. And you've put it off. You've said, "Oh, yeah, one of these days." Don't be the person. I know people who back up all the time who use Carbonite because they lost data. Don't wait till disaster strikes. It's like fire insurance. You can't buy it after the fire. Get it now. Carbonite.com. 2 free bonus months if you use the offer code TWIT. We're talking high tech. We're saving everybody. Can we save Evernote? Apparently, I didn't know this.
No, I didn't either.
According to Business Insider. Now, there is some debate over this. Not everybody agrees. Business Insider says that Evernote is falling apart. Of course, they did replace Phil Libin, their CEO, in July. I like Phil a lot. I thought this was maybe Phil's idea. But now I'm getting the impression that it was the board who was a little bit worried about Evernote. 30 million registered users, 270 million in funding. But they did have to lay off 18% of its workforce over the last 9 months. They're going to shut down 3 of its 10 global offices. And I was kind of stunned. Their actual revenue of Evernote is not huge. What was the number? It was like $30 million.
Everybody thought this was the ideal model, that a small proportion of your audience wants to pay for you. Everybody else uses it free. They've figured out
freemium. They invented freemium, for crying out loud.
Everybody thought they'd figured it out. Yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of sad.
Phil would tell me, "Oh, yeah, we got 5% become paid users, and that's enough." But when your revenue for a company that size is $36 million, that's not a good sign.
A lot of server bills in there, and they're only getting bigger, right?
Yeah.
I think the lesson from Evernote, and for all those people who are out there building freemium services, freemium, the model still works. I don't think this is an indictment on freemium, although there are some movements away. There are some movements toward freemium. There's some movements.
And then a movement away from your Skype, which is frozen solid. He looks so sad. He looks like he's just moaning, bemoaning. my Skype is gone. Oh, Jason. And then Jason's Skype died. I'm sorry. We shouldn't mock a man who's frozen. That's mean.
Microsoft, look what you've done to a nice man. That's what I feel like every time I can't use Skype for my Chromebook, by the way. That's my face.
I used to love Evernote. In fact, Phil once told me, we had Phil on Triangulation, he once told me that something like 3 or 4% of Evernote subscribers are subscribed because they said they heard it about it from me. I've been plugging it for years. And I use it all the time because it's cross-platform and stuff. And I pay for it, but I guess a lot of people don't pay for it. They say they have 150 million registered users, but I guess a small percentage of those are paying for it, and that's hard to run a business on that. Anyway, good luck. We wish you well. This was the week that Alphabet was born. We'll look up back on this someday and remember. Alphabet officially, Google officially kind of became Alphabet on Friday, and they've replaced, is this true, Jeff? Don't be evil with do the right thing?
I didn't know that, but I kind of get, I'm glad they didn't get rid of it. The problem, what they basically did was translated this into a phrase that the very literal-minded can finally understand.
It's an action instead of what not to do, it's what to do.
And it's what it's always been, which is, employees keep us from doing the wrong thing. Make sure we do the right thing. And you have a license to question our actions on this basis because doing the wrong thing would be bad business.
The Alphabet.
It's always been what it is. It's always been the intent. But of course, they get all this crap about the evil stuff. But now you know what's going to happen. I can write the speech for the German politician who's going to say, Google doesn't want to be not evil anymore. Now it allows itself to be evil. See?
It will be evil. This is the, I think this is very good. I mean, these are just words on a page, but maybe if the company really believes this, that it will promulgate through the culture of the company. Employees of Alphabet and its subsidiaries and controlled affiliates should do the right thing. Follow the law, act honorably, and treat each other with respect. I think that sounds great.
Well, but it should be more than that. Unless I haven't read the whole thing, you know, what it should be was.
Yeah, that's just the preface.
Treat your customers first and foremost. With respect, do what they want. You want to do. That's right. That's what it meant. Don't ever screw them for the sake of the business. That's what "Don't be evil" meant.
Google's code of conduct used to have things like it's okay to drink a little alcohol at work, but not too much. And dogs are cool, but cats are discouraged at the office. I mean,
well, that's wrong.
That's wrong,
that's
isn't it?
Wrong.
Oh, yeah, crazy. but that harkens back to a Google of an earlier time when there weren't so many employees. I don't know. Maybe they allow cats now. But that's so Alphabet officially became the entity.
But no ferrets.
no ferrets.
That's something ferrets we can all agree on.
Yeah. No, they're pretty cuddly. You know, it's illegal to have a hedgehog in California.
It's illegal to have a ferret in New York City.
Well, it should be illegal to have a ferret in New York City.
Well, no, it wasn't.
What's wrong with a hedgehog?
I don't know.
More stage fright bugs. Oh, man. This is poor Google. I like Android. I really do. But this is pushing people towards iOS. More than a billion Android users are vulnerable. Stage fright is the media player in all versions of Android. And the security researchers, Imperium Labs, that discovered the original stage fright bug has found a new one. Two new ones that can allow hackers to break into your phone by tricking you to either download or visit a website containing a malicious MP3 or MP4. The stage fright playback engine will play it and you will be pwned. This affects almost every Android device since the first version of the operating system in 2008, even Android 5.0 and later. At least 950 million Android users. There is no fix, although Google, which knew about, was warned about this problem before it became public, is apparently working on a fix and will put that patch out in a couple of, tomorrow, I guess, to Nexus phone users. And they shared the patch to partners a few weeks ago. so that they can get those out. But that's a problem because there's different manufacturers, different carriers. It's always difficult to get the bugs pushed out. Stage fright took a couple of months to fix, and now there's the new stage fright. So be very careful, I guess, about, you know, if you're on an Android device, none of them have been patched yet, about playing MP3s or MP4s from unknown sites.
Yeah, again, unfortunately, the problem is less with any one bug and more that there's no reliable, like, guaranteed way to get this update out to everybody who's got an Android phone right now. Like, I'm sure there are tons of Android phones out there now that still haven't been patched for the first stage fright. And Google's doing what it can, but
it's not up to them, unfortunately. Yeah, they don't get, right. The way it's structured, they don't get to, unlike Apple, which gets to push updates out to all iPhones if it needs to.
Yeah.
Is that now, do you use an iPhone, Andrew, or a Google device?
I use a little of everything. Right now, I'm iPhone and Nexus tablet, but a lot of the time I'll switch back and forth just so I'm up with everything.
Yeah, I do the same thing, although I'm in love with the new iPhone 6S Plus. I may fall in love with the Google 6P.
You better.
I got my new Moto 360 watch, and I do like it better, although I have to say both Motorola, both the Android Wear and Apple watches are really supremely useless devices. They have one purpose. At least the Apple Watch has one purpose, to signal that you're part of the club. And that way you can recognize each other on the street.
You have the new Moto 360?
I do. It's nice. I'll bring it on Wednesday.
Okay, good.
Well, this one's really different. It's huge. It's 46 millimeters, but they make other sizes as well. It's the same.
Have a 42? Is that the other size?
Yeah, there's a female 42, a male 42, and a giant 46.
Right.
But I just thought, if I'm going big, I'm going to go all the way.
I have thin wrists. Worse has been said about me.
You can get the ladies' watch. Yeah. If you wish. And now a malware tool that has your back. Symantec's researchers have discovered a new malware tool called Linux YFATCH that compromises home routers and other internet-connected consumer devices and patches them. Symantec says the malware has infected tens of thousands of routers and other IoT systems around the world. They've seen it for the last 2 months. It seems, in fact, to be designed to harden devices. For instance, on some devices, it turns off Telnet, which is an insecure communications module. It tries to prevent other attackers from using other known vulnerabilities in.
So it's a good.
It's malware? A good malware. It's still in semantics.
If Steve
says
Gibson made malware. This is what he'd make.
Yeah, it's bizarre. The code is unobfuscated and then the clear, as if the author wanted people to know what they were up to. But as Symantec points out, it's still a piece of code that infects your device without your consent. It does have general purpose backdoors that look to be for updates to add other features, anti-malware features, but could be used to add bad stuff. It's just bizarre. It is a, and because mostly because people who use routers never patch them, never think about it. So I'm guessing some, you know, benign hacker made this thing and spread it around. A couple of sad stories. Speaking of hacks, Patreon was hacked. Unfortunately, kind of a nasty. Dan Gooden writing in Ars Technica about this. It's kind of a nasty story because apparently they had left a debugger running on a public-facing part of their website, and the debugger allowed arbitrary code to be run. Worse, they were told about it 5 days before they got hacked. Patreon, Jack Conte's really, really wonderful site that enables creators to get paid by their users, kind of a patronage system. I know a lot of podcasters who use it. That's sad. And now 15 gigs of data have been released into the wild from Patreon.
Once again, we have to get to the point where someone having this data cannot do anything to you. We have to change the transactional end of this, not the data end.
Well, they did the right thing.
Data is going to get lost.
They just They used bcrypt to encrypt the credit card numbers, things like that, passwords. But so did Ashley Madison, and that was hacked. So it's possible that even best practices aren't enough.
What are you saying, Jeff? You're saying we know the data is going to get stolen, so we have to protect the data where it's at. So if it is stolen, it's useless.
Well, that's true. That's part of it. But even then, we know it gets stolen from idiot companies. We've got to get to the point where someone who has your name, address, birth date, and social security number can't do jack, because transactions themselves are more secure.
And we've got to stop using the social security number as an identifier because it's so hard to change. It's a permanent ID number. It's like your fingerprint. Once it's hacked, you're screwed.
Yeah, so we've got to change. I mean, the fact that now we, well, of course, finally America gets chips, but we don't get pins on the chips.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Exactly. It's like, what?
Chip and sign. Well, that's secure. And then T-Mobile gets hacked, but not really, because what happens is when T-Mobile gets a new customer, they send that data to Experian, which then approves or denies the customer based on their credit record. Experian got hacked, and 15 million T-Mobile customers' information.
And so what did T-Mobile do to make up for this?
They gave you a 2-year subscription to an Experian service to protect
Can we spell irony?
Protect your data.
It won't happen again, right? Lightning never strikes twice.
No, it couldn't happen. Couldn't possibly happen again. Yeah. So El Capitan is out. I'm already hearing from anytime you get a big operating system upgrade, I'm hearing from people whose favorite utility stopped working. I noticed a lot of menu bar utilities stopped working. Apple probably disabled the back door that these companies were using. But on the whole, I know you've written a lot of words about it, Andrew. A good upgrade, a worthwhile upgrade, should people do it?
Especially if you're already running Yosemite, yeah, most people are going to have no problem with it. The thing that I think a lot of people are noticing with some of those utilities, and I ran into it myself with the tethered shooting app for my Sony camera, is that this new system integrity protection tool that stops third-party apps from writing to certain like protected system directories. When you upgrade from Yosemite to El Capitan, it's going to move any files in there that don't belong somewhere else. So yeah, it's going to break some things, especially if you have like third-party drivers installed, if you use any third-party toolbars, things like that. Yeah, you might run into some problems. But I've been using it since the pretty early days of the beta, and like basic stuff like Office and Chrome and Firefox and the other apps and things, I've not had any trouble. On my laptop especially, I really like the split screen feature for full screen. You know, I've seen some people kind of making fun of the fact that we went from windowed operating systems to one app on a screen operating systems, and now we're going back to Windows. But when you use the multi-touch trackpad gestures in OS X, you can kind of swipe between these full screen apps really easily. And so I like to have like all my IM apps in one window.
Yeah, I do that.
I like to have a couple. I have like a Chrome tab and a Word app like in next to each other in another window. Like it's been really great, especially for my laptop. On my multi-screen desktop setup, not so much, but can't take that with you everywhere.
Right. No, I even use it on my multi-screen. That means I have hundreds of desktops everywhere. No, it's a good update. Apple, you know, Apple's to be commended, because this is a hard thing to do. We're hearing so many problems with Windows 10. Microsoft seems to have rushed it out, and despite a long public beta period, you know, lots of stuff's not working. One thing that Microsoft does that's not working on here on El Capitan is Microsoft Office 2016. Do we know why that's not working?
Oh, well? have you had problems?
Lots of people saying problems.
Works for me. Oh, which all is right. The most helpful answer that you can give.
Hey, I don't know what you're talking about. Works for me. You must be something wrong with you. It's very hard for me not to say that on the radio show all the time.
It's a holdover from when I worked in IT.
Right. Hey, works for me. Have you rebooted the computer? Is it plugged in? Works for me. Robot taxis, where else? The first autonomous vehicles, Japan, of course. They'll be used in a very small area to take older people to grocery stores. but I think this is great. A robot autonomous vehicle. Initially, I think they'll have drivers in the cars. But I think ultimately the idea is this will be an unmanned service, starts next year. It'll be available for 50 people in the Kanagawa Prefecture, south of Tokyo. But I think it's a start. We're getting there. You're in a Johnny cab. Someday. Someday.
I can't wait for this to go wrong and become a movie with Will Smith in it. I'm really looking forward to it.
I, Taxi.
Oh, boy. Japan still loves its robots, you know.
They do.
I spent some time with Honda earlier this year.
Yeah, you saw the Asimo, didn't you?
Yeah, and some of their researchers that are working on, you know, robots and that kind of thing. I think they're kind of getting to the point where they've done really good with the mechanics, I think, of robots. You know, what we're really at now is where we need the AI, right, to catch up. And that's why so many companies like Google and IBM and others, that's where they're putting all of their research. And they're really changing their thinking about the idea of what a robot looks like, right? Some are humanoid robots like Asimo, you know, that I did some coverage of earlier this year. But I think people are also starting to think of robots in terms of special, you know, more specialty functions, right? And the AI attached to, you know, there's the one that is like an arm that can make dinner, right? It's just an arm and it makes dinner, or it, you know, can do the dishes, that kind of thing. But it needs a lot of AI. It's more about the AI than sort of the function. And this is the same thing with cars and self-driving cars or self-driving vehicles and this kind of thing.
And
it's the AI that's
humans.
Holding us back.
And we await the synths in humans.
Yeah. I just watched two, the Ex Machina.
I like that movie. Yeah.
I thought it was well done. Yeah. And encapsulates a lot of the sort of 50 years of, or 100 years even, of thinking about once we get to the point where the AI works, what does that mean?
It's going to go horribly wrong. That's why.
And that's what there's a professor, at the Idea Festival, the event I mentioned that we covered last week. And he talked a lot, and we talked to him a lot. He's a cybersecurity. He runs a cybersecurity lab at the University of Louisville. He's one of the preeminent sort of researchers in cybersecurity. His name is Roman. Gosh, I got to remember his last name. I can't pronounce it correctly if I did. But anyway, he was saying that, you know, all of these things we're on the cusp of it. Like, you'd be amazed at what we can do and what AI can do. And he said, where we're at now is we need to start thinking at this point of putting the guidelines in place the same way. He said, we need to think about the same way we do about chemical weapons and about nuclear arsenals and things like that. Because we need to put the guidelines and the frameworks in place for doing this research before it becomes dangerous. So he was a real advocate of that. He was a real optimist in terms of how far AI is coming and how fast, how quickly. But his real thrust was like, we've got to set guidelines and expectations and frameworks for this kind of stuff.
We're going to let you all go. It's been a lot of fun. I thank you, Jeff Jarvis. We'll see
Always
you back
pleasure.
Here on
Glad
Wednesday.
To be here at Twit.
Are you traveling anywhere? Are you going to be in town?
No, I'll be in town.
Amazing.
In town, and I will have gone to a Google event Wednesday morning, so I can talk about it Wednesday afternoon.
Good, good, good. Thanks. Andrew Cunningham, Ars Technica. Always a pleasure. Come back soon.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Nice to have you. Works for me.
Yeah, anytime.
Yeah. And, of course, Jason Heiner, and I really owe you a debt of gratitude. Followthegeeksbook.com.
Can't wait to read it.
I am chapter 9.
Yeah, thank you. And Lindsay Gilpin, also my co-author.
Yes, credit to Lindsay. I would
do that. Who's done, you know, amazing job. You know, we've been working on this for over a year, and thrilled that, you know, we only have one left to reveal. And Leo's Exciting. Chapter is amazing. Leo, thank you for your, you know, openness in talking about and answering a lot of questions, spent a lot of time
fun.
On the phone and that. It was a lot of fun. And for Twit listeners too, if you send us a feedback, we have an offer, and we're going to give it to Twit Army first because you know, Leo's so awesome and what's been so great about this is just that, you know, if you send us your feedback about the chapter and why it's so innovative about Leo, you know, send us an email. There's a contact form on followthegeeksbook.com. We'll send you a laptop sticker if you want one, a Follow the Geeks
sticker. I'll send you a nice, I love that Leo. He's a nice guy. Now I want a sticker.
Or any of the other chapters. You can talk about any
I want a sticker.
On any of the other chapters. We are putting the best feedback that we get from on all these chapters, the best feedback and insights we get from readers as part of this process, we're going to add those to the end of each chapter. We're going to it's your chance to get your voice in the book as well.
So if, you know, somebody says Leo's just a son of a bitch, you can put that in there, or does it have to be nice?
I mean, we're going to put the best insight in.
Okay, that might be the best insight. Tomorrow, Max Lebovsky joins us on Triangulation. He's the co-founder of Form Labs, 3D printer company. They've got some really interesting new stuff, including the Form 2. If you're interested in 3D printing, that will be a lot of fun. We had a great week on Twit, including, by the way, Jason Calacanis teaching me Brooklynese on the new screensavers. Hey, get out of here. What are you talking? Take a look.
Previously on Twit.
Water on Mars. Oh,
this is the thing. If you got water, you could have fish.
You could have fish.
You have fish. You could have calamari.
Yeah, but and lettuce.
It's delicious.
Before you buy.
Sigh, I got the new iPhone 6S Plus. Yes, it's pink. I know Apple says this every year, but it's really true. This is the best iPhone ever. Just gorgeous.
Twit Live Specials.
This is the Tesla Model X. Live unveiling, lots of technology, lots of emphasis on the comfort of the interior, including HEPA filters that filter the air from the outside coming into the car.
If there's ever an apocalyptic scenario, you just press the bioweapon defense mode button. This is a real button.
The new screensavers.
Is it living? Is it made of cells?
Is it living?
Is it made of cells?
Is it living?
Is it made of cells?
Is it living?
Are we gonna find out? Investigation time.
Twit, making the world safe for technology.
Yes, we wrapped. Man. Hey, what's coming up this week? Mike Elgin will tell us.
Coming up this week, Microsoft is holding an event in New York on Tuesday, October 6th. The company is expected to unveil the Surface Pro 4, two Lumia handsets, and a new Microsoft Band wearable. A Google event in New York on Wednesday, October 7th, will probably announce a partnership between Google and Twitter to offer their open source alternative to Facebook's instant articles for making news articles appear quickly on mobile phones. Recode's Code Mobile event kicks off on Wednesday in Half Moon Bay, California, and runs for 2 days. And the new Steve Jobs movie, penned by Aaron Sorkin and starring Michael Fassbender as Steve Jobs and Seth Rogen as Steve Wozniak, opens on Friday, October 9th. Critics, including The Real Woz, are saying the movie is insanely great. That's what's coming up this week. Back to you, Leo.
Thank you, Mike Elgin. Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern Time, 1700 UTC for Tech News today. And don't forget, at 4 p.m. Pacific, Tech News tonight at 7 p.m. Eastern, 2300 UTC. Jeff's going to be at that event, so we'll get your report on Wednesday from the Google event. And we will be covering the Microsoft event live, 7 a.m. on Tuesday. I guess we'll be getting
big week
early. Big week ahead, as always. Thanks so much to Andrew, to Jason, to Jeff Jarvis. Thanks to you for being here. We do Twit every Sunday afternoon, 3 p.m. Pacific. That's 6 p.m. Eastern time, 2200 UTC. Would you stop by and watch live? It's nice if you're in the chat room. But if you can't, don't worry. On-demand versions available of all of our shows at our website, twit.tv, and wherever you subscribe to podcasts, including our own Twit apps on all the platforms. If you'd like to be in studio, we had a nice studio audience today. Thank you all for being here. Just email tickets at twit.tv. We'll put a chair out for you. I'm Leo Laporte. Thanks for being here. We'll see you next time. Another Twit is in the can.
Amazing. Wow.